afternoon, everyone. How are you? Welcome to TEDx Adams Morgan. I'm so proud to be your MC today. I am going to help host this whole evening, afternoon and evening, and I'm also very proud to have such a diverse range of speakers. I'm so happy to be here. My name happens to be Shireen Mitchell. I'm a web pioneer, founder of Digital Sisters. I'm known as the original Digital Sister, so if you ever look me up in social media, you'll find me. I was one of the first, actually the first woman of color web firm in Washington, D.C. area back in the days of AOL when that was the biggest thing we knew, and that today is Facebook. But I've been here in the D.C. area for over 20 years, so I'm so happy and proud to be in the neighborhood that's you know, Adams Morgan, that's so diverse. I've been here for all the changes, and I'm so excited today to be your MC. So what we're going to do today is we're going to have a couple of videos and some fantastic speakers. So be engaged and be supportive of the speakers that come up. And the first up, we're going to do a video by Derek Stevens. It's called How to Start a Movement. So get it with TEDx Adams Morgan. All right. So first up, we're going to have our first speaker, Amar D. Singh from Sikh Coalition. He actually is a co-founder of that. It's a civil rights and human rights. He's a civil rights and human rights activist. That organization focuses on those issues, and he's now going to present.
Hi. Thanks so much for allowing me to be here before you today. 9/11. I was actually here in D.C. I was pursuing a graduate degree. After you finish your law degree, if you're really nerdy, you want to get another specialization degree in international human rights law over here at American University. And let me get to my slide. And I was staying in Arlington. And because the area Arlington I'm in was dangerous, I kept the faceplate to my radio in my backpack. And so when I got in my car to drive into an externship I had in D.C. on the morning of 9/11, I didn't have my faceplate on my radio. And so immediately I get into my car and I see a police car flying by. And the police car went by so fast that he hit the meridian, the divider in the road, back straight up and went straight. And I thought, that's strange, must be an emergency. I'm going to keep going to D.C. because, frankly, I was late for my externship. And I get into D.C. and I can see that people just look a bit off. They're looking at their phones very quickly. They're sort of looking at their phones as if they're trying to use it. But I was late, and the building had changed for my externship at a place called the World Organization Against Torture. And so I go into the first building and I say, excuse me, I'm sorry, but is the World Organization Against Torture here? And somebody immediately says, pointing at me, watch out for that guy. You're the concierge. You need to make sure he's okay. Now, I'm from New Jersey. I've got an attitude. And depending on my mood, I'll either start trouble or I won't. So I brushed it off because I was late. You can tell I'm from New Jersey from my accent. Is that why you're laughing? So I went to the next building. I said, is the World Organization Against Torture here? And the gentleman said, yes, but the World Trade Center has been attacked. The Pentagon has been attacked. We've been told by a Secret Service, since the building was close to the White House, to evacuate the building. Now, right away, I knew that I actually had to get out of D.C. and get back home to New Jersey. Growing up during the Iran hostage crisis, my pop would be told to go back to Iran. And during the first war in the Persian Gulf, I would get crank calls at college saying, go back to Iraq. And then after the Oklahoma City bombing, before folks found out it was McVeigh who had done it, a law school colleague had joked, your folks are going to catch a lot of heck for what happened in Oklahoma City. After the first World Trade Center attack in 1993, a house of worship, a Sikh house of worship in Glen Rock, New Jersey, that I attended growing up, was defaced. So pretty much knew what was going to happen. And so my car was literally parked north on Connecticut Avenue, and I literally drove straight to New Jersey. The scene was chaotic in downtown D.C. Cell phones were not working. I knew why. About an hour and a half out of D.C., my cell phone was working, and I had probably the worst conversation of my life with my mother. My mom called, and she said to me, "Are you okay?" "Yes, Mom, all right, you're talking to me. Do you have your bandana in the car?" I said, "I do." She said, "Put it on." I said, "Mom, I'm not going to put it on." She said, "Please put it on." I said, "Mom, I'm not going to put it on." For a Sikh to take off their turban, since it's an external signifier of our internal commitment to be just and loving in everything we do, to take off our turban is literally like trying to take off our head. It is who we are. It represents our values of justice and love for all of humanity. And I, as an American, was not going to take off my turban because I was not going to let the terrorists win that day. And so my fiance at the time called. She also asked me to take off my turban. And I said, I'm not going to do it. I'm just not going to do it. I'm going to drive home. I'll be okay. And by the time I got back to New York, to Jersey, it was about 2:30, so it took a while to get back. And we started receiving the first reports of hate crimes in Richmond Hill, Queens, where there's a big Sikh community. The Sikh house of worship there had already been defaced. A worshiper who had gone to pray for the victims of the attacks in the city was brutally beaten with baseball bats. 60-year-old plus man was hospitalized. Two kids who I knew growing up who had been shot with paintballs by people. So we knew what was going to happen, and so with that, I actually turned my head and never went back to my graduate law degree program, and ended up co-founding the Sikh Coalition, which is the nation's largest Sikh civil rights organization. The work is tough. It's tough. Society is figuring out the intersection between our expression of our faith and the law. And the law is not nearly where it needs to be when it comes to protecting the rights of our community. But I gained a lot of inspiration starting this work when a gentleman named Ronaldo Rivera at the Justice Department, their Community Relations Service, he said to me, "You know, Umar, anything worth fighting for in your life is something that you're not going to actually realize in your lifetime." And it, over time, I've really begun to understand the meaning of this. We look at our 41st president, whether you like him or you don't like him, the man is literally standing on the top of a pyramid. He's standing on the top of a pyramid. And at the bottom of that pyramid are the first slaves, Harriet Tubman at the Underground Railroad, Frederick Douglass, who started the first abolitionist newspaper, the North Star, who said, "You know what, we want freedom." And then at the next level of the pyramid are those folks in the antebellum South who resisted a segregation as best they could. And on the next level are people like W.E. Du Bois, who founded the NAACP in 1909 and said, in an organized way, we're going to start addressing our dignity as human beings in this country. And at the next level is Rosa Parks, who in 1955 said, "You know what, I'm not going to sit on the back of the bus." And at the next level are the people who marched with her and fought for the rights that people like me now enjoy. And then the next level are people like Jesse Jackson, who said, "You know what, maybe a black man can be president in this country." And then right at the top of that pyramid is the 41st president. But it was literally centuries of struggle of people who would never see that moment that made it possible. And so that resonated with me, this idea that there's a real beauty in fighting for something that you might not necessarily see in your lifetime. When I sort of got into this work farther in 2008, the Sikh community, because we have an epidemic of bullying in our schools, basically over 70% of the kids in our schools, according to reports that we've taken, suffer bigoted bullying in schools. And the community started marching in the streets in 2008 in New York City, in Richmond Hill, and said, we need a regulation that will define the problem, will have a reporting period by which it must be investigated, will have the appropriate means of addressing it. There'll be a report back to parents. There'll be tracking of the phenomenon so that we can better address it. And what I told those the folks who were marching in the streets for a chancellor's regulation in New York City to address school bullying was, you know, in the 60s, my guess is that nobody in the South could have imagined that a person with a turban on their head would be invoking the rights that you that they fought for. And my guess is that nobody, you cannot imagine the people who are going to be invoking the protections that you just are fighting for so that 1.1 million school students in New York City are protected from bias-based bullying. So the struggle for justice is very, very, very long, as we can see here. And those are pictures of those marchers. You know, I wanted to end my talk by showing you pictures of my two boys. On the top left is Nishan, and at the bottom is my older son, Azad. Azad's name means freedom, and Nishan's is identity. Given my background and my sort of experience as a Sikh and as an American, these words have a tremendous amount of meaning to both me and my wife. And I'll tell you, I'll be honest, as a parent, I worry because I know that the chances are more likely than not that my son, both of them, will face violence and harassment in school, just like I did growing up. I wonder about how they're going to be able to endure it, whether they're going to be able to endure it and be able to still stand up and feel dignified and free. And I hope that you know, one day, you know I feel like I've failed in some way, that I haven't been able to create an environment in this country where they're going to be safe from this. But I want them to know, and other kids to know, and other communities to know that are enduring discrimination, that are on the side of the world's sort of have-nots, so to speak, that, you know, the arc of the universe, as Dr. King loved to quote, really does bend towards justice. That they can, if they put their mind to it, create real change. That they can create real change now, and that they can create change that is part of a longer historical process that they might not see in their lifetime, but is truly, truly possible if they put their mind to it. You know, let me give you a few examples. You know, just tomorrow, for the first time, it might not be a big deal to most communities, but for the Sikh community, it means a lot. There's going to be a briefing at the White House. Over 50 leaders, selected leaders from around the country, are going to be briefed on civil rights issues that matter to our community. Racial and religious profiling, school bullying, and workplace discrimination. It might not seem much to most. It's not a change in policy. It's not a change in law, but it's a start. It means that the community is being recognized and we're getting there, that the folks who tomorrow are going to make history for the first time by being in the White House and representing our community, they are part of that process of change that might happen in their lifetimes, or it just might not, but that's okay because they're part of the process. Similarly, last week, the New York City Metropolitan Transportation Authority, right after 9/11, they told members of our community, if you want to wear your turbans, you're going to have to brand your turbans with our logo, or you're going to have to work in the back. Now, it took us 7 years to litigate that case, and last week, the case was settled, and the MTA completely capitulated and recognized the bigoted nature of forcing Sikhs, and only Sikhs and Muslims, to brand their headdress as a condition of working out in public view. It takes a long time. You will enjoy victories in your lifetime, but be aware that the truly great things you're going to do are going to happen after your lifetime. And be aware that that is part of, as a human being humble in understanding what real change takes and what is necessary to create the change that people remember throughout their lifetime. So with that, I thank you.
So next up, from the Heritage the Hispanic Heritage Foundation, is Antonio Tijerino. Sorry, he actually focuses. The organization focuses on the president of that organization, and the youth actually deal with community building, community service, as well as workforce development. So getting youth jobs. So up next is Antonio.
That's not the kind of youth we deal with. I don't know where that picture came from. Can they take down these pictures? Because those aren't mine. All right, let me start. You can't put conga so close to a Latino on a stage. I warned you guys. So I am here to talk about youth leadership and allowing youth to lead. I think it's an issue that we really have to deal with in America right now. I mean, I it's funny talking about it, though, because I think God is paying me back for being an iconoclast when I was young by making me a middle-aged man that deals with nothing but young people all the time, 10,000 of them, and they all have very different ideas and creative ideas. I lead a youth movement in America, a true youth leadership movement, and the smartest thing I did was to figure out how dumb I was and put them in charge of it. And since then, I've been getting awards and recognitions at the highest levels. But I really am kind of riding their coattails. I think that I cringe every time I hear someone say, this is the next generation of leaders, and this is tomorrow's leaders. They aren't tomorrow's leaders or the next generation of leaders. They're today's leaders. I mean, could you imagine with the technology that these kids have at their disposal, what it would have been like for Gandhi or for Martin Luther King or for Cesar Chavez if they had Facebook in terms of their movements? Actually, could you imagine getting friend requests by Gandhi or Martin Luther King or Cesar Chavez? I would definitely say yes. But this isn't 50 years ago, it's today. And we have no choice in terms of allowing them to lead. There's a statistic that I heard the other day that 10,000 baby boomers are going to be of retirement age every single day for the next 19 years. That is a huge gap, and it needs to be filled. And we need to go forward, but I think part of the problem is that established leaders are standing in the way. I think we have an issue where established leaders that are my age or older, it's always interesting when I'm in a meeting and I'm the youngest guy in the room, and trust me, I'm older than I look, it's that good Latin skin, but I think people feel threatened by youth, or they feel as though they don't trust youth to lead. And I have a real problem with that because I've been working with some of these young people for many, many years. I mean, I oversee a network of 75,000 16 to 30-year-olds. They have run for office. They have invented things. They have come up with social solutions. They have patents on their inventions. They are affecting each other in a positive way. They're leading. And I always say that the greatest form of leadership is when you lead leaders. An average leader leads followers. A great leader leads leaders. And I want to be in that arena in terms of some of these young people. It's funny because when I'm around others that are of my contemporaries and we're talking about some of these issues, I feel as though youth is seen as like houseplants. You know, you like having them around. You know that they look nice. But at the end of the day, if you water them too much, they're going to grow too big and get out of control. And I do think that that's part of the issue that we deal with. I'm trying to figure out what happened to the older leaders. And I'm going to quote a song from our era, baby boomers era. Come mothers, come fathers throughout the land, and don't criticize what you don't understand. Your sons and daughters are beyond your command. Your old road is rapidly aging. Please get out to the new one if you can't lend your hand, for the times they are changing. That was their anthem. I mean, did they forget? I haven't forgotten. I remember when I was young. Nobody paid attention to me. If I had an idea when I was a young guy working at Burson Marsteller or at Nike or some of these other organizations, I had to get an idea and pretend it was someone else's in order to have it heard. I don't want to be put in that situation. I had to fight for someone to mentor me. I followed them around. Literally, follow people around and sit in and be honest with you, eavesdrop sometimes in terms of getting some kind of direction and guidance in terms of how to move forward within the organization or to move my ideas forward. And I was a very creative person. There needs to be a value on the perspective of youth. I discovered very quickly when people talk about what you need to make it, they always say, hard work. You need to be smart and you work hard. Well, don't tell me that you're going to work harder than the guy I just passed that was breaking up concrete on a construction site and that's going to turn around and go wash dishes at night. You're never going to outwork that guy, or possibly his wife, who's cleaning a hotel room possibly and then turning around and taking care of somebody else's children. You're not going to outwork those folks. So hard work isn't it. It's being creative. It's being resourceful. It's being positive. It's being innovative. Those are the things that are going to make you stand out. And so I just want to counter that Bob Dylan quote with my own version of an updated quote, which is, I've got 99 problems and youth ain't one. So I feel as though the actual solution is in youth leading us forward. Because real leadership is servitude. At the end of the day, it's about how we can serve someone, how we can position them, how we can help prepare them. And we bring value because our experience does count for something. And we've made a lot of mistakes. I know I certainly have. But we don't seem to want to tolerate someone else making a mistake, allowing them to fail, actually instilling them a confidence to be able to fail. Half the battle I have when I deal with young people is, don't be afraid to fail. Take chances. And then you have a whole other side of the world that's telling them, don't take chances. Be conservative. Follow leaders. It's funny because the Pew Hispanic Center did a survey about who the most important Hispanic leader that they can think of. And do you know that 75% couldn't name one? Now, I know when this study came out, there were a lot of Latino leaders that weren't too happy, and I'm sure a lot of leaders, because I think they wanted themselves to be mentioned. I was actually thrilled, because if you asked me that question, I would name dozens of Latino leaders, except they're all about half my age. So there is no shortage of talent out there. The reason I like being around youth is what I learn from them. You know, it's interesting. The teachers that were older than me, they always taught me history. When I talk to young people, they teach me the future. And if I had a way out, what I'd rather learn about, history or the future, I'll take the future every time. So I have these meetings here in Washington, especially at the highest levels, where a lot of us will sit around and talk about issues that we're trying to solve. And I mean at the highest levels, and I'm very fortunate that they're gracious enough to invite me to sit in on these meetings. And I'll ask, where is the representation of youth here to get their perspective? And they said, oh, but we have a youth program that they can be a part of. We have youth committees that they can be a part of. But you know how insulting that would be if you said the only women that should be part of this group should be in the women's group, or the only Latino or African American or Asian. I want to hear from youth. I think they're smarter than most of us, definitely me. They're more technologically savvy than most of us, definitely me. They're more energetic than most of us. I'm pretty energetic, so on that one I think I'm about even. But you have to raise your expectations and you have to of youth, and you have to challenge them to come up with solutions. You know, we play a role, but we need to get out of their way. And that's the greatest thing that we need to do when we're leading youth. You prepare them, you motivate them, you instill confidence in them, and the most important thing is getting out of their way. I was very fortunate that I dealt with some significant leaders that ended up giving me a lot of confidence. I always believe that the two greatest motivators in life are when someone believes in you or when someone doesn't believe in you. And I was fortunate that some of these folks actually believed in me, like Dr. Pedro Jose Greer, or Dr. Orlando Taylor, or Raul Izaguirre, or Consuelo Kickbush, Dolores Huerta. These are very important people to me that believed in me. My job is to serve as they did for me with young people. I wanted to read a quote by Cesar Chavez that youth must have initiative, should not be mere imitators, must think and act for themselves and be free. Free to lead. Age isn't an accomplishment in itself. We act sometimes as established leaders that by virtue of being older, that somehow we accomplish something. An accomplishment is actionable. And when a 20-year-old can come up to me and design some phone app that allows a parent to teach their child that couldn't normally be able to afford sending them to preschool and is able to create something that allows them to give that kid a head start to get into when they get into kindergarten, that to me is an innovative thought. There is no hierarchy when it comes to creativity and innovation and creative thought. So I just want to close by saying that it's very personal to me. And I've got three little kids. I've got a 6-year-old, a 4-year-old, and a 1-year-old. When the young people that I work with are my age, my kids are going to be their age. And I want them to have that same compassion, that same trust, and that same savvy to go forward and lead us, lead America forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Antonio, for that. So next up, we have Brian English from CHF International. He happens to be a program innovator, and his innovation is actually urban poverty. And so they focus on international poverty. Right now he's working on a project in India. However, the innovation and what needs to happen in terms of poverty across the country is what this organization focuses on. And Brian's going to tell us a little bit about that. So thank you, Brian.
Today, I'd like to take you on a journey to India and talk about how we can create smarter cities with the urban poor. Let's begin in Bangalore, India, where Sarissa lives. Sarissa lives in a slum, and she makes her living recycling waste. There's 20,000 people in Bangalore alone that make their living this way, and typically they earn $2 a day. Historically, this is one of the most marginalized professions in India. It was reserved for the untouchables during the caste system. For the past 3 years, I've also been living in Bangalore, India, as the director of an international development organization called CHF International. We partnered with 3 city governments and hundreds of slum communities with funding from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and we designed and implemented solutions that would help reduce poverty and create smarter cities, more productive cities, more inclusive cities. 1 billion people live in slums today, and that number is projected to grow to 2 billion by the year 2030. People like Sarissa are drawn to cities in search of greater social mobility and jobs, or they're fleeing the countryside as a result of natural disasters or conflict. For decades, these slum populations have been marginalized. Governments sometimes demolish their housing and treat their investments with disregard. Sometimes they send them back to the countryside and think that this will be a bad dream they can just forget about. But if you sent Sarissa and other informal sector workers out of the city, you'd essentially be cutting vital city services. In the case of informal waste collectors, they recycle 600 tons of waste every single day. That's 20% of the city's garbage generated every day. This has significant cost reductions for the city. They don't have to fill up landfills as quickly. They don't have to transport it to the landfill. They don't have to pay for the handling because this population does it for free. This also has a significant reduction on greenhouse gases. And all this ensures that India has one of the highest recycling rates in the world. So I guess in many ways, these are the invisible environmental workers of the city. But on the other hand, they're treated as thieves and they're harassed by police. They're exposed to toxic chemicals and poor working conditions. And their work is nothing short of drudgery in many cases. So what does inclusive planning look like with this population? Well, Mother Teresa said the worst thing about poverty is not the lack of food or shelter, but the feeling of being no one, the lack of identification, the lack of public self-esteem. So we partnered with the city of Bangalore, and we issued identity cards to this population. These ID cards authorized them to collect waste within the city limits. It validated their livelihoods and put them on the map. It also allowed them to access other services from the government, like healthcare. We've issued 6,000 ID cards so far, and they've been handed over by the city's mayor and commissioners. Then we constructed formal recycling centers in the city. This is space where the waste can be sorted in a safe and efficient and productive environment. It's legitimate space for legitimate occupation. We've constructed 7 of these centers so far, And in total, they recycle 49 tons of waste every month. Sarissa works at one of these centers. She works with 13 women, and they collect waste from about 4,000 households. She used to make $2 a day. Now she makes $5 a day because they can aggregate larger amounts of materials and sell it at a higher price. The city government has been convinced of this approach, and now they've agreed to construct one of these centers for each of their 198 wards. Sarissa was elected president of the enterprise that runs one of these recycling centers. Her colleagues liked her. Together, she helped them set their targets for the day and kept each other accountable for doing their fair share of work. She also liked the camaraderie of working at this enterprise. They could talk about their issues like domestic violence and healthcare. They also saved their money together and took loans from each other. But a couple months ago, Sarissa quit. She got a better job as a maid in a house. If you're surprised by this, you shouldn't be, because Sarissa, in many ways, is just like me and you. She's making rational economic decisions to do what's best for herself and for her family. She took this job so she could be closer to where her child was being watched during the day. Now she's taking another job. We have many misperceptions about the urban poor, and these misperceptions misguide and skew our solutions. Slums are where the informal city's workers go to sleep at night. Slums are not stuck, just as their residents are not static. The urban informal sector is an incredibly resilient population. They've developed sophisticated mechanisms to deal with everyday shocks and volatility. They've also proven that they're capable of organizing, they have their own networks, they can save their money, and if given the chance, they'll invest in their neighborhoods and make it better. But too often we treat the poor as welfare recipients. This underestimates their capacity, and it reinforces patronizing relationships. Instead, we need to give these people tools, tools for ownership, tools for security, tools to get them connected with the wider economy. So that's what we did in Pune, India, which is outside of Mumbai. We engaged residents of slum like these women, and we asked them to collect information on their neighborhoods so that we could help them explore the conditions and take action. We had over 1,000 individuals sign up from the slums to help us do this. And together we collected information on the social, economic, and living conditions of over 500,000 households. That's equal to almost the entire DC population. We then aggregated this information into a geographic information system, and we housed it within the city government. And for the first time, the city could see citywide patterns about these populations that they had never seen before. This filled a tremendous information gap that was living in the shadows of the formal living environment before. For example, in one slum we saw that 80% of the families had to use open space for toilets. There was no sanitation facilities. We could see which households had to rely on public water taps and which had gained access to individual connections. Then we gave this information back to the communities, and we taught them how to explore the results of the surveys. We taught them how to organize community meetings and talk about the common issues that arose. We taught them how to seek consensus and how to prioritize what they wanted to take action on. Then we taught them how to mobilize their own resources and which doors of the government to knock on to get additional resources. We call this process micro-planning, but at its core, I call it empowerment. In total, we helped 128 slum communities undertake this process, which were home to 250,000 individuals. In every single case, they took tangible action to improve their neighborhoods and their living conditions. Drainage pipelines were constructed, water tanks were installed, classes for teenage mothers were instituted. In one community, when the women learned that their husbands were getting into alcohol too much, they went and formed a pressure group, and they shut down the local liquor store. Another group of women, when they learned that they're all experiencing issues with domestic violence, they went and demanded that they get a police station installed in the community and even made sure it got manned with a police officer. Another group got sick and tired of selling vegetables alongside the road near speeding traffic, and they said, we need a vegetable market where we can sell in a safe space. We've documented this process in a format that the community and government can continue to use and replicate in the future, and we're still doing this even today. We also conducted a survey. We did focus groups with 118 individuals from 9 of the communities we worked with. And one of the residents said this. She said, Once there was a debate on the availability of garbage bins and water taps, and because of the mapping, I knew exactly the status of my cluster, and the elected representative had to listen to me. There's a lasting legacy of empowerment there, and I think those are the transactions of democracy. We've entered the urban age. Over the next 30 years, 2 billion people will be added to the planet, and most of this growth is going to be happening in cities in the developing world. It's a dramatic departure from the past, and it's a window of opportunity to get serious about planning cities. So we shouldn't look at this as a failure, because cities are not failures. They're signs of success. They've proven themselves as engines of economic growth, places of innovation, sources of job creation. And so while cities are currently concentrating poverty, we should also see it as an opportunity to escape it. Let me leave you with 5 things that I think if we as an international community can champion forward, we can solve this. First and foremost, we need to engage the urban poor as active agents. Change is not something you do to people, it's something you do with them. And unless we get this basic fact, we're not going to go anywhere. 2, we need to build the capacity of local governments who are dealing with an unprecedented growth and change. 3, we need to engage the private sector. We need to incentivize them to move down market and make goods and services like housing more affordable. 4, we need to support political leadership that's willing to challenge the status quo. And finally, we need to end policies and practices of exclusion that marginalize the poor socially, economically, and politically. I think if we do these 5 things, it'll be possible to imagine smarter cities and a world without slums. Thank you very much.
So I have the honored guest of the Secretary of State for the Protection of the Amazon in Ecuador. She's up next, Yvonne Baqui. She's going to tell us a little bit about that. However, she happens to be someone who's been inspired by the arts and found the magic in being able to use the arts to help with ideals and sharing them. So now we have Yvonne.
Great. Thank you very much. It's such a pleasure to be here with you today, really. And I want to thank very much TEDx for organizing this kind of events that are for the people. That's young, the young generation, the people. It's making the difference. What Antonio mentioned about the young, I think they are the ones that are the present and future generations. And you are doing that, Antonio, helping that. But I wanted to talk to you about this initiative. It's the Yasuni ITT initiative. It's one of the most biodiverse places in the world. It happens to be in the Amazon of Ecuador. Gladys, thank you for being here. It's a unique place. It's a place that I just came back a few days ago. I was there. It's a place where you feel that you are in the middle of a creation. It's 1 million hectares, around 10,000 square kilometers of the Amazon in Ecuador. And just in 1 hectare, there are more plants and trees than all the United States, Canada, and Mexico together, to give you an idea of the high biodiversity that is there. And the scientists, they ask, but why is it that this place in the Amazon is so different than the rest of the Amazon? And it's because of the geographical position that we have there. It's in the intersection of the equatorial line and the Andes Mountains, between the tropics of Cancer and Capricorn. And because of this altitude that it is, and because of the position that it has, it's why climate change, global warming, has never affected that unique place. During the last ice age, it was 12,000 years ago, it was not affected. Before that, millions of years ago, it was not affected. It will never be affected because of this position. That's why during the last ice age, when the Amazon became a savanna, the only place where it stayed intact was the Yasuni National Park. All the animals from the Amazon came to the Yasuni National Park, and that's why we have prehistoric animals that live there. And also, it's rich in all the biodiversity, but also we have the last 2 indigenous communities that live in voluntary isolation that live there also, the Tagaeris and Tarumenanis. But we have another richness that's underground. That's oil. 20% of the oil of Ecuador is there. So this is the dilemma of the government of Ecuador. What do we do? We want to protect. Ecuador is known for the protection of the environment. We have the Galapagos Islands that are the most amazing islands in the world, protected for such a long time, where Darwin made his theory of evolution. But we have this other treasure that's Yasuni. So that's why I wanted to present you a video that will show what we did and how the president of Ecuador 4 or 5 years ago in 2007 presented this initiative as an idea to the Assembly, General Assembly of the UN. Now it's no more an idea, it's a reality. So I would like to present you a video, short one.
The Yasuni National Park, located in the Ecuadorian Amazon rainforest, is an exceptionally unique biodiversity refuge. 1 hectare in Yasuni contains more species of trees and bushes than all of North America. Two isolated indigenous tribes, the Tagaeri and Taromenane, inhabit, together with the Waurani, the Yasuni National Park. Yasuni ITT, an initiative to change history. Ecuador has proposed to the world an innovative plan in order to confront the challenge posed by climate change to the future of mankind. Ecuador proposes to leave beneath the Yasuni National Park the 846 million barrels of oil that are within the ITT block. By doing so, the emission into the atmosphere of 407 million metric tons of carbon that would have been released by the burning of those fossil fuels are avoided. In exchange, Ecuador requests that the international community assume its co-responsibility by contributing no less than half of the revenues that would be received by selling these oil reserves. Direct benefits of this initiative. The non-emission into the atmosphere of 407 million tons of CO2 and the guaranteed non-exploitation of these petroleum reserves. The conservation of the immense biological richness within the Yasuni National Park, declared by UNESCO as a biosphere reserve, along with the conservation of 39 additional national parks, adding up to the most biologically diverse reserve on the planet. Respect for the cultures of the indigenous tribes who live in isolation within the boundaries of the Yasuni National Park. Reforestation of 1 million hectares. A decisive impulse to the country's transition from an extractive economy based on petroleum exploitation towards a more sustainable development model with broad use of renewable energy sources, respect for biodiversity and increased social equity. The Yasuni ITT Fund, the CGY's Certificates of Guarantee Yasuni ITT. The Certificate of Guarantee Yasuni ITT will become a financial instrument issued to the initiative's contributors and donors by the Ecuadorian state. It will serve as a guarantee that all the oil reserves that are now underground will remain there permanently. It is a non-interest accruing instrument with no maturity date, given its permanent nature. It could only be redeemed if the Ecuadorian government were to order the exploitation of oil within the ITT fields. All income generated by the international sales of the CGYs will be deposited in an international trust fund managed by the United Nations Development Programme. What investments will be made with the Yasuni ITT Fund? Effective conservation and prevented deforestation of 40 protected areas of Ecuador. Reforestation, forestation, natural regeneration and effective management of 1 million hectares of forests. The expansion of the actual renewable energy generation in Ecuador, taking advantage of its enormous resource potential in hydroelectric, geothermal, and solar power. Improved social development of areas of influence of the Yasuni ITT initiative projects. Who is supporting the Yasuni ITT project? The Yasuni ITT Fund will receive donations from different sources, contributions of countries from all over the world and international cooperation, responsible corporations concerned with the future of mankind, philanthropists worried about the possible consequences of climate change, small donors and global citizens who would access our website. An initiative to change history. The petroleum stays there, underground, forever. Covered by this unique biodiversity, protected by the Tagaeri and Taruminane, by their ancestral rights. By nature's harmony. Yasuni ITT.
It's about prevention. Not remediation, it's about prevention, because according to Kyoto, what it says, cut the trees, reforest, and we'll give you money. We're saying we don't want to cut the trees. We cannot touch this plate. It's a paradise, it's a sanctuary, we cannot touch it. So we are asking that. We are a partner now with the United Nations Development Program, as you saw, and we have a trust fund. I would like to tell you that we have now more than 12 countries that are supporting, but we're not concentrating only with governments. We open it to the civil society, the philanthropists. Any person could support by giving any amount, and it's the youth that are the ones that are moving the most. Wherever I go to present it, it's the young generation that inspires me the most, because they are the ones that understand what the meaning of protecting the environment is. So we are getting support from so many people all over the world in an amazing way, and still we need to show it more, to make it more known, because it's far away and because we haven't done yet the campaign, international campaign, to make it known. That's why I wanted to show you something else, very, very short. I know we don't have time, but very, very short, of something with it to bring it closer to the people, to understand what it means to touch such a place, such a national park. We took it to New York, to one of the most iconic and known parks in New York, the Madison Square Park. And I would like to show you this video and finishing with it, what it represents.
our park, right? Yeah. This is our park!
You should be allowing this.
This is what I gotta do. It's my job, right?
How does it make you feel when they pump oil in the park?
I mean, I thought these parks were for the people. I mean, I bring my kids to this park.
No. You gotta talk to your representative.
What the hell is going on?
Because I don't have any power here. I gotta do what they tell me, right?
Calm down.
Trees. We're not supposed to be digging for oil in this park.
But the thing is, they put this thing in a public park.
Officer, this is totally unacceptable. You understand that, right?
Is there anything we can do about this?
They're entitled to. They have a permit. There's nothing we can do.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This is the campaign, I Am Yesuni, so everyone will feel part of it and connect with our purpose. And please be part of the solution and help us do it. Thank you. Thank you.
Wow. That was powerful, wasn't it? Thank you, Ambassador, for bringing a little bit of Ecuador here. Appreciate that. Definitely that last video, you must probably appreciate that, because if you think of oil drilling in your public park, and like the woman said, my kids play here, if that was the same thing in your backyard, I'm pretty sure we would do something about it. So that's definitely a first change, and definitely appreciate her coming to show that for us so we can see that. A lot of times most people don't think about things unless it's happening in their own backyard, and unfortunately there's so much going on from their backyard, and we have to think about that. So up next, Kavita Patel, actually a practicing physician in the DC area. She's a fellow and managing director at the Brookings Institute, and she's gonna talk to us a little bit about health. So next up is Kavita. Thank
you. And I'll start with a story, because this is something that I feel can best be conveyed by a story. So I have a patient that's 62 years old. Her name is Helen. I told her I would be mentioning this just to be sure, even though I'm pretty sure it might be hard to track down the Helens in DC. She's 62 years old. She comes in. She actually doesn't live anywhere near Washington, DC. She couldn't find a primary care provider, and I was new into the area, so she came to see me because I was the one person that could see her in the next couple of weeks. And she had her hair done up in this beautiful updo. Her makeup was picture perfect, always just dressed to the nines. And she had some minor issues with blood pressure and takes a baby aspirin every day. But really not much to sit down and say, well, we've got to see each other pretty often, Helen. So I did the usual things, the stethoscope thing, you know, my white coat, and we talked for a little while. And then I said, you know what, Helen, things look good. We need to make sure you do the following things. Honestly, you know, I don't want people to feel like they need to see a doctor if they don't need to, you know, but here's a way to get in touch with me, and let's make sure we see each other. It's 6 months because I want to check some blood work. So the next week, I saw her again in my clinic. I saw her on the schedule, and I thought, oh, something must have happened. Maybe she had something come up. No big deal. She sat there prim and proper, and same thing. I knew it took her about 2 hours to get to the clinic, not to mention parking in DC, not to mention everything all of you know when you have to come into the city or stay in the city. And I said, what's going on? Is there something? Do you need something? And she was like, well, I just, you know, you said that I had to check my blood pressure. I thought I'd come in and get my blood pressure checked. And I thought, okay, that's wonderful. You know, she and I didn't know each other that well, so that's no problem. All right. Next week, same thing. Helen's on my schedule, and I'm starting to get a little bit of a complex. Like, what did I do wrong? She's coming back all the time, and I'm not asking her to. Am I missing something? And we sat down, and we talked, and we talked for a long time. I see about 32 patients in a day. I spend about 7 minutes at best with each patient. All of you can probably commiserate with that, because nowadays your doctor is probably at a computer typing and not even looking at you. I put everything away. I even told my nurse, watch out, because I think I need to spend like a good half hour with her and figure out what's going on. I don't feel like she's telling me everything. And when we got to the end of probably about 45 minutes of talking, and I was backed up, but I really felt like I actually understood what was happening, I realized that what was going on was that she was lonely. She had lost her husband a couple of years earlier through cancer and an unfortunate, because 62 is pretty young in my opinion. And as I get closer to those ages, I think it's really young. So I love the theme of youth, but I'm gonna apply it to the 60-year-old set. But I started to realize she's lonely. I can't really code for that. I can't really even bill insurance for that. But she connected with me, I connected with her. And I was the one person that she could make an appointment with and see. And even if it was for 7 minutes, it was something that was regular, and it was something that we could both be invested in. So that started to get me thinking about this concept of what being a patient is. So any of you that are kind of Latin junkies or Greek origin word junkies might know that the word patient actually means to suffer. And I find this really, in this age of empowerment, I found it really disappointing that to say we're all patients means by nature we're all suffering. And so I thought, how do we end suffering? And when I see, and I mention Helen just because Helen was the perfect story, but I think I see it 32 times a day in different ways. And then when I think about when I go home and my husband, who I love and I'm lucky to have, and I met him a little later in life than a lot of my friends, I see loneliness every day in what I do, even when I'm at the Brookings Institution working on national health policy and things that are very important to our country. So then I started to try to dissect what's really happening. There's a researcher in the University of Chicago named John Cacioppo, and he actually wrote a book 2 years ago called Loneliness, and I corresponded with him and read the book. I recommend it if anyone's fascinated by this. But I said, John, is this a popular notion? Have you heard a lot from people? And he said that he still, to this day, this was 2 years ago and it's 2012, he said every day he gets about 5 or 10 emails with people asking for the solution. And he said it's increasing just a little bit over the last couple of years as our economy has decreased. And then I started to look at the science of loneliness. And there's actually now enough studies that have proven that dementia, Alzheimer's, some of the neural disorders that we have in our brain, and some of the things that I think all of us want to avoid, can actually be accelerated by what we call social isolation or loneliness. And when you think about, then I looked at the statistics around the cost of healthcare. As some of you may know, we spend trillions in the United States every year on healthcare, trillions of dollars. And we know that at least 30% of that trillions of dollars are what we'd call wasteful healthcare. Well, instead of thinking about it as wasteful healthcare, I'd like to offer that maybe we should think about it as dollars that we should be repurposing towards understanding what's really happening in healthcare in our world and in our society, and especially locally in our communities. And then I looked, thinking about this research, thinking about the cost, looking into the science a little more and thinking about some other startling statistics. Antonio thinks that he's the least tech person. I feel like I'm the least tech person, so maybe we can have a competition. But every minute, 200 million emails are sent, 100,000 tweets are sent, and we have about 30 to 50 new hours of video uploaded every minute to YouTube. So you would think that in this day and age of all this contact, that we would not be as socially isolated. Well, we're now finding there's been some study to keep with the theme of youth and community a little bit. We've been looking, there have been researchers, and I've been a part of a team that's looked at teens and girls and boys in terms of what their connectedness means to things like their health, like obesity, which we know is on the rise in the United States. Ironically, the more connected people are, the more that they felt like they were isolated in terms of behaviors that we think are good, like exercise, getting outdoors. And that doesn't mean that we should tell them to all put Facebook away or turn off the computers and all of a sudden they'll be healthier. But I think we're tapping into something. So let me return back to loneliness a little bit and tell you that if we thought about the trillions of dollars that we spent and we thought about the human interactions that we had every single day, could we actually combat this notion of being a patient that suffers? And I think we could. I know that out of all the patients that I see, the 32 a day, I know that at least half of them, if I were able to spend a little bit more time with them, that we would understand much more than on a scale of 1 to 10, how do you feel? And have you made sure you had your shots this year? Those are all very important things, but there's much more than that. So let me give you another statistic. We have about 21 million veterans in our country. because of the drawdown in Iraq and Afghanistan, there's going to be thousands and tens of thousands more that come into our country over the next, come back to our country over the next couple of years. They do a survey for healthcare as soon as troops come back to the United States. And I'm from a city in Texas where we had a huge military presence. And the most common factor across the board in the 10 to 11 million veterans that report disabilities, and these include mental disabilities as well as physical disabilities, is a sense of isolation. The most common complaint that one out of three returning veterans are having is that they don't feel like they have anyone that they can talk to. And these are people with families, and these are people of all socioeconomic backgrounds. So we're tapping into something, and we're finding things in our country and trends and patterns that we need to do something about. So where are the solutions? I feel wholeheartedly like the solutions are from within, and I do feel like it's something as common when I've thought about interactions every day and when I get on the metro, just even having a way of thinking about the people around you and being more conscious of it is a way to deal with the social isolation and the loneliness that I know is driving a lot of what we're seeing in not just our healthcare system, but in the country and in our community. And when I look at some of the presentations that were already made today, and when I think about the power of possibility, I'm more inspired than ever that the answers are within each of us, and finding a way to also identify more clearly how we can combat this notion of suffering and loneliness. Imagine if you would, so I'll take you just a step into what I think healthcare in the future could look like. Imagine if you would that you're not just restricted to talking to someone like me in 7 minutes every so many months out of a year, but imagine if when I had you with an interaction with me, if I could say to you, like I could have said to Helen, and I could, and I didn't, if I could have said, Helen, you know what? You've got to go back to your home. You've got to drive 2 hours away. Here's a way to text me. I want to make sure that we touch base with each other. And just like I've got reminders on my calendar, I would have a reminder that let me know that I need to get in touch with Helen just to see how the knitting club meeting that I encouraged her to go to in her community, because it popped up on our Google map when I looked at my phone and I was able to tell that there was something going on that I knew was mutually interesting to her. What would the conversation look like then when she did come back to see me to get her blood pressure checked? I bet you her blood pressure would be better. I bet you anything that there would be a different conversation that we had. So there is an amazing potential that I feel like we are on the verge of tapping into, and it's a combination of taking kind of the inspiration from within. So I'll end with telling you that one of the ways that I'm trying to deal with this, even in my daily practice, but I find barriers from a regulatory perspective. We try to protect patients' privacy. It's very important to do that. But in an effort to protect patients' privacy, I'm not allowed to just text or tweet or email with patients unless it's done through some of the secure portals. And if any of you have tried to get into some of these, they can be really hard and cumbersome and clunky. So I actually tell all my patients now, every single one, I ask them, I say, I'd like to have an ongoing relationship with you outside of these 7 minutes, if you'll let me. That means that we might do things that are not part of your medical record, and I might ask you questions you would never think your doctor asks you. Questions like, how many people do you feel like you trust in your life? And what do you do every day? What do you do at night? Do you ever feel lonely? So I hope with some of this that I've stimulated you to think about it and perhaps taken all of this into consideration. Instead of thinking of trillions of dollars and billions in waste, we can repurpose that back to something that the community can own and actually make a positive outcome from. So thank you.
Thank you, Kaviva. Thinking about that, in this age of digital age, the other challenge is, of course, is not having access to those things. So even as doctors may be trying to reach patients, we still realize that some patients may not even have those tools. So something for us to think about. So up next, if you notice that the theme that we've had, you know, there were several speakers that actually spoke about youth. We have today an opportunity to have, okay. Hi. I'm going to do this stuff out of their way.
Sorry.
We have an opportunity today to actually have youth come and do a dance for us. And this is a dance troupe. The youth is our future, as you know, and we can't have innovation or forces of change if we don't consider our youth in the process, which is why you've heard it so often today. The other thing interesting is that when you think about that, you generally don't put the environment and the youth together. So when we talk about Mother Earth and things that go on with the environment, we generally don't think about youth in that conversation. But we are honored actually today to have a dance troupe that has been dancing around DC, talking about the environment in their presentations. They've also danced with the mayor for an event for the mayor. So they've been well known in the DC area. So I'm proud to have them here today. And I actually have a guest who's gonna tell us a little bit more about the troupe and give us some more details about why they're working on the environment. So Brooke Webb, can you come out for a second over here? Thank you. Can we give a hand for Brooke?
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. As she already said, my name is Brooke Webb, and I'm a part of the ENF Rangers. We are a group of youth ranging from 9 to 16, and we are a performance group, so we sing and dance to raise awareness for environmental issues and to promote sustainable living.
Thank you, Brooke. I appreciate that. So we're almost ready. We're going to get set up for their troupe, and they're out here now. And I think we are done, and we're going to be entertained. And thanks so much for you being here and watching the troupe dance.
Rangers, ready?
Let's go.
Cutting down trees, by changing to fluorescent light bulbs, and by sharing the principles of environmental sustainability with all my friends and family.
We are your children, with futures to unfold. Let's build a family, and the whole world will see. The way to bridge a gap is unity. We are your children, with futures to unfold. Let's build a family.
Come on, let's build a family.
Let's build a family.
Oh,
Wasn't that great? Oh my goodness, another hand for them. They were fantastic. I'm so impressed. Forces of change, if our youth are the future, my goodness, if we have more youth with that energy talking about our environment, we will be saved for sure. That's for sure. So we're going to come into break right now. Actually, I just wanted to make a note. If you noticed, Crystal High is not able to make it, so if you noticed the name on the and she didn't speak, that's why. Just wanted to let you know she just couldn't make it today. Actually, the other thing I want you to know about is Google's here in the room, just off the front door. If you're leaving from this way, it should be on your left-hand side. They're showing and displaying. They have a couple of computers in there, and they're actually showing and display the Google Places. For those that aren't familiar with Google Places, it's just one of those sort of check-in places, for, like Foursquare or whatever. And the local ones are now actually integrated with Google Plus, so they've been doing some upgrades. So I'm not sure if you're familiar with Google Plus, but there's, if you have your profile, Google Plus is another one of their apps that you can be a part of. So if you want to find out more about it and see what they're doing, you can do that up front. So we're going to take a break. Definitely happy about what we've had so far. I just want to give another round of applause to all of our speakers. They've done a great job. Such a diverse range of conversations, and I'm hoping that will fuel you for the forces of change moving in the future. We're going to have about a 10-minute break, so right now take a 10-minute break, and we'll get started with the program afterwards. And thank you. All right. Thank you for everyone who came back after break. We still have an exciting agenda. Again, my name is Shereen Mitchell. I'm the MC for anyone who's come here for the first time today, this afternoon. So we're going to get started with a video, and we're going to move on with the several other speakers that we have. We have, again, a very diverse range of speakers today, and I'm excited. I'm actually so excited about the entertainment we just had with the youth. They were so excited, but they were also so very critical of themselves. So they were very, very much perfectionists, which was fantastic. So, that's just great to know that there was passion. They really believe in what they're doing. I love to see that, and it definitely came out in the show. So right now we're gonna do a video. The video is Bobby McFerrin. It's about music, hacking your brain with music. So up next. That was so cute. I was like, I should dance over in the back. I want to do it with them. Actually, he's right, though. Everyone gets that, right? It doesn't matter what language, doesn't matter what you do, doesn't matter what your background is. That's something that people can get. So that was a fantastic video. So up next, Emily June. And actually, Emily's name spelled, if you see the spelling, it's like, oh, yeah, I can say that. It's phonetic. Emily June, I love her name. She's an AU student. She's actually into food. So she's majoring in all things food. But she's definitely focused on issues around food culture and sustainability and that kind of stuff. So up next is Emily.
Good afternoon, everyone. As the art introducer and wonderful speaker said, I'm Emily June, and I'm excited to speak with you today about urban agriculture and food security. Now this works. So you might be wondering, how and why am I interested in food justice? First of all, food is an absolutely essential and necessary part of our everyday life, and it's necessary for human health and happiness. On top of that, I really love growing food, I love cooking, and like most people, I love to eat, you know, big foodie. On top of that, I come from a farm family background in the Midwest, so my experience with growing food started at a very early age. And then on top of that, I had the incredible opportunity to study abroad for 4 months, just this past fall, in Havana, Cuba. And while I was there, I volunteered at Organoponicos, which are organic urban gardens. And I saw while I was there this amazing system that was actually developed during the 1990s, what's called the special period in Cuba, very difficult economic times, where people grow their food locally and eat it locally. You can walk right around the corner, and usually every 5-10 blocks, there's an Organoponico where you can get locally grown food. So I started thinking to myself, could we take that model and bring it here to the United States, where we also are in a difficult economic times now, and where we have many food deserts, which are areas where the community lacks access to fresh fruits and vegetables. How can we address social injustice and inequality through growing our own food in urban areas? So when I started digging deeper, what I found was what is called, what I personally call, the new dichotomy of malnutrition, which is when you have simultaneously areas of traditional hunger and lack, as well as excess and obesity. So as Kavita mentioned earlier, the United States has one of the highest obesity rates in the world. But alarmingly, on top of this, as of 2011, the World Health Organization found that 65% of world population lives in an area where you're more likely to die from complications of being overweight than being underweight. And this is the first time in human history that this has ever happened. And the reason for the new dichotomy of malnutrition and also for this obesity, being more likely to die of obesity than being underweight, is poor food policy. So we have to ask ourselves, how can we respond to this enormous challenge? And how can we, both through policy and through local initiatives, start to come up with solutions? So firstly, I'd like to go through some of these terms that I'll be using in the discussion. Like everything, these terms are politicized. Kind of can't get around it. So at the World Food Summit in Rome, 1996, these terms came out. You have food security, which is simply having sufficient access to safe and nutritious food, and that tends to be posited by the Food and Agriculture Organization and by governments. And then you also have food sovereignty, which means being in control of the production and distribution of your own food, which is put forth by La Via Campesina, which fights for the rights of landless workers, landless farm workers. And so although these two terms are somewhat competing and politicized, for the purposes of this discussion, I'll actually be talking about both food security and food sovereignty, which you understand later when I get into the research that I did earlier this year. So how is food security measured to understand the research that I did? One, you have to have access to food that is safe. Two, you need food in sufficient caloric amounts and balanced caloric amounts. Three, you need food that meets all of your nutritional daily recommended values. Four, you have to have access of course, to the food, because whether or not it's there doesn't necessarily mean that you have access to it. And fifth, you have to have a consistency of the access to that food. So where does my research fit in terms of what else is going on with food security? Who else is writing about food security and food sovereignty? First of all, in 1966, the United Nations came out with the Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights Covenant. And one of the rights that was enshrined in this was the right to food, because, of course, it's necessary for our survival and towards living a healthy life. Unfortunately, we still have a long way to go to get there, and that's where this research and the food justice movement come in helping to make this human right more prominent and helping to bring nutritious and safe food to more people around the world, and also putting people in control of their own food. After this, in 1977, you had Francis Moore Lapey, who created the organization Food First, which does wonderful research on food justice. And additionally, she started putting forth books talking about the fact that scarcity is a myth, that we have the ability to feed and nourish the entire world, and the reason it doesn't happen is poor policy. And following in this same strain, Amartya Sen in 1981 produced Poverty and Famines. He was inspired to write this essay after a famine in Bangladesh, which lasted from 1971 to 1974 and was created again through poor policy. And in this essay, he actually argues that what we're lacking is not sufficient amounts of food. What we're lacking is empathy towards making sure that everyone has access to safe and nutritious food. And on top of that, there is scientific evidence that has proven by the Food and Agriculture Organization that the Earth has the capacity to nourish twice as many people as currently populate the world. But still, we don't do that. And that's because the Earth has enough to meet everyone's need, but not enough to meet everyone's greed. So we need to turn this around. So my research question is, can engagement in urban agriculture aid in increasing the equity of food security in the DC area? And my hypothesis was that if an individual is engaged in urban agriculture, then they will in fact have a higher level of food security. And how did I go about this? Firstly, I had wanted to do research at a nonprofit organization called Bread for the City, and they have a rooftop garden. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to do the research there, but when one door closes, another one opens. And I also had some wonderful mentoring from my research professor at that time, and she helped me to come up with the idea of just show up at some gardens and talk with folks. So I decided to do semi-structured interviews at three different urban gardens in Ward 6, Capitol Hill. Why did I choose Ward 6? One, there are many gardens in the area, and you know that makes it easy to walk up to folks and say, hi, can I interview you about your garden? And I had a fabulous time doing it also. Secondly, this is a mixed income area. Third, Ward 6 straddles northeast, southeast, and southwest, which, if you're familiar with DC, have very different dynamics from one another. And fourth, there's an interesting paradox that I like to explore about inequality within centers of power. So as we know, the United States is the most powerful nation on Earth, and DC is the center of that power, and Capitol Hill is the center of the center of power, and yet still we see in this area inequality. So let's explore this, let's see what's going on with this, and let's try to address it as well. So this is a list of the gardens, as well as the gardeners, where I did interviews. The first one was quite large, about 60 plots, and it's been around for about 8 years after it was rehabilitated from a drug park. The second one is only in its second season, and it tries to bring together new folks who have moved into the neighborhood, or generally young and college-educated and white, as well as the older black folks who have been in the area for a very long time. So it was more of a community builder. But it was very interesting to me because part of the community that serves through this garden is very low income, and they live in government-subsidized housing. And then the third is a garden that's been around for about 15 years, and it's about 30 plots. So what I found was that for 11 out of 16 gardeners, or approximately 69%, there was an increase in food security when this person was engaged in urban agriculture. And this supports the hypothesis that if you are engaged in urban agriculture, you can, in fact, gain food sovereignty and food security. So it's a very exciting finding. And as you can see, these are my statistics for the amount, the consistency, nutrition, and safety that were increased for those 11 out of 16 gardeners whom I interviewed. So now we get to the part we're really interested in, which is, what are the possibilities for the future? What are the possibilities for positive change? Firstly, something I hadn't necessarily expected, but I noticed once I started doing interviews, was that many people include their children in the gardening. And I had this light bulb moment where I was like, wow, like that's an amazing opportunity for the future. If you have urban gardens, or garden anywhere really, and you include more children in the process, you're teaching them from a very young age. You're growing gardeners from the time that they're children. They're learning biology, they're learning ecology, stewardship of the land, they're learning good nutrition habits, and they're getting outside, getting some exercise, and you're building community as well. And then secondly, the area that's most interesting and that I'm most excited about, and I hope that some of you here are excited about as well, is the potential of bringing together some nonprofits who would like to provide funding and support for communities who live in food deserts, who don't have access, either fiscal or physical, to food that is healthy and nutritious, to more fresh produce. You know, a community where you have foods that are more accessible, that are calorically high but nutrient poor. How can we connect nonprofits to support these types of communities to people who want to grow their own food? Connect them and create more urban gardens wherein you can be empowered. A theme that I've heard from both Tony Tijerino as well as, I think it was Evans, both of them were talking about, this is all about empowerment, about helping people to help themselves. And if we want to help people help themselves to gain better nutrition and to live healthier lives, then I think it would be an excellent idea for us to support more gardening, more growing of our own food. So God willing, I hope that we will be able to put some of these initiatives into practice and make them reality in the future. And thank you so much for your time.
Yes, props. This one's going to be interesting, don't you think? Milk and Hershey's and okay. So next up is Murray Mann from Global Diversity Solutions and Global Diversity Solutions Group, actually. And he's going to talk a little bit about diversity. And diversity actually happens to be something very, very important to me. As I said earlier, I founded an organization called Digital Sisters, and I focused specifically on issues that were impacting women of color and the issues around technology. And so I spent, the last 20 years or so focusing on diversity once I learned that there was a big, big challenge in that area. However, if you notice, it hasn't quite changed over the 20 years, unfortunately, and we still have some work to do. But, I do fight for that and work for that and do a lot of things in terms of talking to communities as well as corporations and nonprofits like that. But today with Murray, he's going to talk more about it. He's actually going to use some props that I actually think about using these after this is done because I think this is going to be pretty interesting. So next up is Murray. Come on. Welcome.
When I received the invitation from TEDx Adams Morgan, it came with a BYOC, and so this is the chair I decided to bring. I'm warning people in the front of the audience that sometimes it speeds up. So be careful. Okay. Today I'm going to talk about crowdsourcing diversity to inclusion. It is the intersection between social media and diversity that will exponentially drive inclusive workplaces and irrevocably alter corporate and organizational environments. Now, why is this important? Our nation is encountering a perfect storm, and that perfect storm is not the sea that from the movie, but it is the convergence of economic crisis, major multicultural shifts, unemployment versus critical skill shortages, and globalization. So this perfect storm, corporations are not prepared to navigate. They lack the cultural competence to effectively address the change that's coming. So we need to find ways to make a difference. And so that's where we look at diversity and inclusion. It is our economic survival, our economic survival, sustainability, and success will be based on moving organizations forward. The processes that they currently utilize fail to make any difference. In fact, we are at the point where organizations are completely unable to shatter the glass, concrete, tortilla, bamboo, and rainbow ceilings. So let's talk about this a little bit more. Okay, let's see what we have here. Okay, we have a demographic tsunami facing this nation. Women have surpassed men in the workplace. People of color in the last decade made up 85% of our population growth. Yet, and these are just a few statistics, yet what happens is we have a severe underrepresentation of people of color and women in senior management positions. This creates major problems because the people making the decisions on how the businesses move forwards or to address the workplace do not have our cultural and intellectual input at the decision-making level. So, I'm going to go back. So basically, what I wanted to do is demonstrate this. And I'm going to do this. Andres Tapia, who wrote The Inclusion Paradox, coined the phrase, diversity is the mix, and inclusion makes the mix work. So what we have here is corporate America 2 decades ago, or it's known as homogenized milk. So the next thing that they did is they launched diversity recruitment initiatives. But as you can see, pour in a little more. And there's a reason why you have to keep pouring a little bit more. And that's, as you can see, employees tend to end up on the bottom. So this is, you can't just drop diversity in. What you need to do is you need to stir it up, agitate it, and intentionally do that. So that way, you can have people at all levels of the organization. But there's still a problem with this. It's one flavor. Organizations tend to want everybody to think alike and act alike. That will not create change. And what happens is you end up with corporations recruiting but failing to retain talent. You get a revolving door. And so, again, what is the way to go about this? You know, actually, when people go into the door, they end up seeing a sign that says, hired for diversity, rewarded for conformity. And so, and Let's say that again. Hired for diversity, rewarded for conformity. Okay, as I said, it doesn't make change. So what happens is that we need something like this salad, where the unique, complex flavors contribute to the organization. And by the way, I'm going to share this with you. We have some great dressings. And it's those flavors. The return on inclusion investment brings to the table, it reaps the talent, unique perspectives, cultural knowledge, creativity, and energy of the emerging workforce. It also means that you're creating new ideas, diversity of thought, and that's how internal and external change will occur. And within organizations that get it, what you see is they not only recruit, but they onboard, mentor, engage their employees. They take their employees through multiple stages so that they can advance in the workplace and continue to contribute to both business success as well as organizational success effectiveness. So, where does crowdsourcing come in? Well, crowdsourcing comes in this way. And this is where the difference is. Instead of the traditional recruitment methods that tend to, and where these organizations that stay like this, what happens is that they also totally eliminate the very talent, not totally, but pretty much eliminate the very talent they're trying to recruit through their corporate culture, organizational barriers, and unconscious bias, and micro inequities. So what I have here is an example of a company that is far from a technology company as possible. This is a food and service organization, a food and cafeteria type organization. Yet they have been leading the way. They're one of the companies that lead the way. It happens to be Sodexo, but you have Cisco and other organizations, the technology organizations that truly reap the talent. And what they do is they leverage all of the social media rather than just, they go to where the talent that they're looking for lives on the internet. But they not only go where they are, whether it's Facebook, Twitter, or other social media areas, they also go to the Professional Diversity Network, which has a number of multicultural sites, and they allow their employees to engage with the people who come on these sites. So they actually, if you're in a specific field, you can talk to the IT community, you can talk to the food service community, you can talk to almost any community. And that you're not only talking with recruiters, but you're talking with the employee resource groups, and you're also communicating and building relationships with hiring officials. That creates a relationship that breaks down the gatekeepers that are keeping minorities, women, and people with disabilities, millennials, and many others from getting into the positions and then moving up into the organization. So that's an external platform. But again, and they have apps, et cetera. And so it creates real conversations and real engagement. Now, on the internal side, because really what's happening is there are three trends. There's the leveraging that external communication through social media platforms. They have developed internal engagement networks so people can collaborate not only in their work places, but they can collaborate with out in other business units, cross-functional communications, and when that happens, it allows people not only to build their own skill sets, but allows them to be seen, embraced, engaged, where people then not only are seen for their contributions, but they're also generate champions, create mentors, and get better assignments, and finally advance in the organization. So it's leveraging these type of technologies and having the conversations behind the corporate firewalls that is moving those organizations that have applied it, and about half the organizations in the country are starting to do this, that is creating the internal change that is also making a difference in how successful these companies and organizations are. So then there's, and as you can see, people can chat in their groups, they can network, they can communicate with each other, and they can also do it more virtually. The first one was more like a Second Life platform. This is a Cisco platform where people are communicating in, and again, driving change within the organization that moves companies or not-for-profits forward. But then there's a third platform, and I call that the Open Inclusion Initiatives, which fosters boundaryless collaboration. That is where companies and customers and they're literally crowdsourcing with their potential employees, building long-term pipelines, and they're then creating new products, delivering improved services, and they're actually rewriting the job descriptions and reauthoring what the company does. Now, utilizing both of the internal platform and external platforms, they're breaking down, they're destroying the silos and the barriers and organizational cultures that have prevented change, the change that we're going to need in order to be sustainable and successful in the future. This last example happens to be an initiative between the Department of Education, the several corporations, academic institutions, and community-based organizations. And this is called Education to Career, and it is addressing current shortages and also helping people move into positions and so that we can increase employment. So what I'm asking the TEDx Adams Morgan community is you take your vibrancy, your successes, your diversity, and join in to crowdsource diversity to inclusion so that our nation can be successful and advance in the world. So thank you.
Out of here. All right. So actually, that was a really good, display. I was thinking about it when he was putting it together. I was like, wow, yes, diversity, homogeny, yeah. How does that go together? And silos, of course, you have everything in there and you can see it. I was always interested. I'm originally from New York City, so I've always been interested in the concept of the melting pot. And I was like, well, the pot doesn't quite melt, does it? But things inside supposed to melt, but then we get the homogeny instead of the salad. So maybe we should be calling it the salad pot instead of the melting pot. And then we'll get diversity. So up next, we have Lori Kaplan, who actually happens to be the executive director of LAYC, which is the Latin American Youth Center. The Latin American Youth Center has been around in the DC area, particularly Columbia Heights area, for several years. She actually focuses a lot on youth. They have been doing some amazing things in the city, and she's going to share some of that with you.
Well, I'm so happy to be here, and thank you. Gosh, I feel like we've been to Ecuador today. We've been to India today. We got a little spice of Cuba, and the youth were phenomenal. So I'm really glad I wasn't following them. And I guess it's my job to kind of bring you home, to bring you back to the neighborhood, to bring you to Adams Morgan. because I've been really fortunate to live and work in this neighborhood for 35 years. So when I thought about the forces of change and my work over the years, I thought, well, perhaps it's a little different than Amar Deb, who spoke about hoping that he'll see that change in his children's lifetime. You know, my desire, honestly, is to see that change now, one by one, for young people that I work with. When I was listening to Antonio, I thought, wow, you know, there's just like millions of kids out there doing extraordinary work and are showing the leadership of today and tomorrow that he so articulately talked about. But yet my job today is to talk about something a little bit different. Because when I think of forces of change in my community here in Adams Morgan, sadly there are a community of young people who are still struggling to realize all the hopes and dreams that we want for them as we would want for our own children. So there are a community of young people, 16 to 24, who are leading very complex and complicated lives. Researchers have called these kids disconnected. And sadly, that's just another label that they've just been given. But really what that means is they're 16 to 24 years of age, and they're not connected to the systems that are really designed to encourage them, to support them, to love them, to educate them, the systems of school, the systems of family, and the systems of community. The Obama administration has flipped that label, and now they're calling these young people opportunity youth. So that's a little more positive. It's young people 16 to 24 in search of the opportunities, in search of the realization of all that they hope to do in their young lives. But the challenges are many. And I just read a report from the White House Commission on Community Solutions that said there are 6.7 million opportunity youth in our nation today. One out of seven between the ages of 16 to 24 who are unemployed, maybe have a high school diploma, maybe don't, but they really don't have a sense of hopefulness for their future. That report also says that our nation spent $93 billion on those young people in 2011. And I'm thinking, on what? You know, was it foster care? Was it youth jails? Was it hospitalization? You know, what if that $93 billion was spent on community college and job training and all the things that these young people need so that they can realize their talent, their skills, and their aspirations? Yet their lives are very complex, and they wear a lot of labels. Those labels are teen parent, juvenile justice offender, high school dropout, homeless, youth criminal. There's many of these labels, but in fact, their lives are complicated and very complex. So I'll tell you about one young woman, Maria, who wandered into one of our sites. She was 18. At that time, she was 18, a teen parent. She came in because she wanted a GED. Seems simple, walked in the door, she wanted a GED. Of course, out the gate, we know there's no simplicity to this story. As a teen mother, she had no real safe and secure place to live. She was couch surfing between her mother's house and her boyfriend's house. There was violence in the relationship. She had no fixed address. She had no access to childcare. She started our GED program, quickly dropped out because of the lack of childcare. We put her in an internship program. Her aspiration is to be a nurse. She loved it. She did it for 6 weeks. She was at a doctor's office. They offered her a job, a further type of internship. She couldn't do it because of the childcare. She got a job at Subway. She quit that after 2 weeks, and that's how the story goes. So I think to myself, okay, what are the ingredients? What is the recipe? What can we do right here in our own community? What are the services and supports that need to wrap around the lives of these young people so that we can, in fact, be a force of change, so that they, in fact, can be the change and the transformation that these young people want in their lives can occur? the Youth Center has a bit of a recipe, which I'll talk about some of the ingredients. The most important part of the recipe, and you all know this, is a relationship. A caring, loving person in their lives who are going to be there in the long haul. All of you can think of someone. Perhaps it was a mother, a teacher, someone in your faith-based community, but you had someone. Sadly, these young people don't. So what we have done is create the reality where these young people can develop a relationship, learn to trust, someone who can celebrate the successes in their lives, be there for the long haul, because these are not quick fixes. This is not a mentoring program where you go out and have a soda once a week. This is much more intensive than that. They need someone who will love them, trust them, be there for them, and help them navigate the complexities in their lives. They also need real services. They need housing. They need childcare. They need counseling. Often they need mental health supports. Maria was incredibly depressed. And once we did sort of, she got into the center and started trusting someone more, those things begin to pull out where you can get the mental health counseling. But we believe it's got to be under one roof. It's got to be one-stop shopping. These are not young people that you can just sort of send on these referrals and hope that someone will treat them well enough to embrace them, encourage them, and bring them in. They also need to be relevant in the lives of these young people. These kids are 16 to 24. They're resilient. They do have talent. They do have aspirations. But what we do for them has to make sense. If those systems had worked, they wouldn't have disengaged from those systems to begin with. So we have to create an environment that's culturally relevant, that's developmentally relevant, that's fun, that's colorful, that offers them great things to do, that brings them in, because they're not going to walk through the door and say, gee, I'm feeling down. I really want to talk to that mental health counselor. What they're going to do is walk in the door and say, I want a job, and I want a GED, or I want to go back to school. But as you begin to peel the layers of that, you realize all that they need in the services and the supports, and they need access. They need to learn how to negotiate and navigate through these incredible myriad sets of services that, quite frankly, would stymie any one of us. Often they live in very impoverished neighborhoods, and I don't remember if I mentioned that in D.C. alone, we think there's 9,000 to 10,000 kids who fit this definition. The last thing they need is results. You know, it's not just about talking to someone. It's really about getting the job done with a razor-sharp commitment to a no-failure attitude. High expectations, you're going to stick with them it's not a linear path. You're going to hang in there, and you're going to navigate this, but you're going to get the results that these young people need, and you're not going to give up. There's a lot of talk now in the nonprofit community about evidence-based evaluation and proving return on investment and what works. And as you read these documents, you'll start to see measure what you treasure. And while I do think you have to take all this with a bit of a grain of salt, because some of this is just common sense, I also think you do have to be very intentional in working with these young people to look at and to use data and to listen to them and to measure and to make changes and to, you know, not do the same old thing year after year, because that led to the results that brought them through our door in the first place. So when I think about what are the things that we do to try to embrace these complex young lives, to be the force of change, to move them to their aspiration, these are some of the ingredients of our recipe. Now, some of you may be wondering how Maria's doing. She's been around the Youth Center for a couple of years. It's not a little box that I can put a bow on and say, you know, she's just doing great. But what I can say is that she is back in the GED class. She has severed the relationship with the boyfriend. She charged him in court, so she's now getting some child support. She's in counseling with her mother because she's moved back in there, and we're working on repairing that relationship. She has a mentor at the Youth Center, who's with her through every step of this, celebrating the small successes. She wants to be a nurse. She really understands and has had the mental health supports also to know what she needs to do now to navigate these circumstances. So it's not easy. It doesn't happen overnight. These are long-term commitments. And sadly, today, too many people think it's a program, it's a quick fix, get them in, get them out, check off the box, open the case, close the case, and it will all be a happy scenario. Now, I am really lucky because I've been at this youth center for 30 years, so I've seen a whole generation of success stories. And they were, in fact, what the literature would call disconnected, what the Obama administration would call opportunity youth. And I think of this one young person, Nelson, who came to the youth center when he was 12. He grew up in our foster care system. His passion was baseball. We worked with him. He got a scholarship to college. He's now working on his master's degree. We all went out to California for his graduation. And we were there. We were the ones that navigated it, and he has a full-time job. I think of Ronald, who came to the United States as a result of the war in El Salvador. He was suffering from post-traumatic stress syndrome. I met him years ago. He actually got arrested for selling and distributing drugs as a young person. We hung in there with them. We navigated the court system. We repaired relationships with his mother. We worked with his faith-based community. Today, he's an art teacher. He's an amazing artist. That was his passion. He's doing great. He's bought a home. He has kids. He's very happy. And then I think of, well, the list could go on, and I see the clock ticking here, but I guess what I would like to leave you with here in Adams Morgan, there are young people living in poverty whose lives are really in great need of transformation, and we are all that force of change. It can be a young person on your corner. It can be getting them to a center in your neighborhood like the youth center, but making sure that if you bring them in, if you support them, that you're in for the long haul. Because too many adults have let these young people down, and that's why they're in the circumstance that they're in, and it's our job to be that force of change as they seek to transform their lives and be the kind of young person we want for all of our own children. So thank you, and I have to say those youth were phenomenal. You know, just seeing that, I know, hey, every young person should be that. It was great. Thank you.
The youth, forces for change for us as our youth. So up next is Rebecca Davis. She's the VP of Social at Ogilvy. She actually has a passion for dealing with social media from a consumer's perspective, and she's going to share a little bit about that today. Rebecca.
First, a few disclaimers. I am here expressing my own personal opinions, not the opinions of my employer, Ogilvy. I am a chronic armchair economist, so I'll put up some charts. And I really bring to you a lot of information that's available in the public space. So some of the people I'll talk about are actually clients of ours, and others are not, but all of this information that I'm getting ready to share you can find on the internet. So go ahead and get started. So I'm calling this Playing Long Ball, Business Driver as a Dramatic Opportunity for Social Change. And so to give you a little context of who I am, and I've had the privilege of going to a lot of pretty elite institutions, and I've actually worked with some pretty amazing companies, pretty large companies. But I come from Alabama, by way of New York. This is my grandmother and my mother in about 1947, and it's about 18 months after my grandmother decided that she wasn't able to stay in the marriage that had produced my mom. And so she started a life of being a single working mom without any support. And I'm incredibly proud of her. She was incredibly important to me as I grew up. And she then entered into a career in which she never made more than $18,000 a year, but over a long period of time was able to save and invest and left quite a sum of money to my brother and I, who are her only grandchildren. I tell you that story because for me it illustrates the power of what business can do and the power that wealth can have in someone's life who has to remain completely independent, who's the child of immigrants, and who wants to leave a better life for her kids and her grandkids. So you might know the name Michael Porter, and I was able to attend a conference that he held last week. And Michael's thesis is that there's only one institution in society that can create wealth, and that's business. It's a pretty profound statement, especially for a crowd like this. NGOs are phenomenal at taking resources and understanding societal problems and distributing those resources to try to solve those problems. Governments are incredibly good at collecting resources, collecting money, and allocating that money to solve infrastructure problems, to build agencies, to kind of instruct and build society. But there's only one institution that can actually build wealth, and that's business. That's the private sector. And we do that through an amazing thing called making a profit. And Michael Porter describes this as a magical process by which entities, businesses, understand a need within the marketplace, within consumers or other businesses. They find a way to meet that need, they sell whatever that is, and they mark it up. And it's that delta, that's that in-between space, that turns into wealth. And wealth is what makes it possible for us to potentially solve societal problems, for us to feed our kids, for us to buy our houses, for us to rent our apartments. So, of course, when we talk about business, we have to have a conversation about what's been going on for us in the United States over the last several years. And this is a chart that actually shows the jobs that have taken place and what has happened in the manufacturing sector over the last 40 years. Now, what happened in early stages of this, you can see this is kind of the ramp-up period when my grandmother was investing. There was a huge alignment between the manufacturing sector, between the business sector, and between the people who were working in that sector. And what happened over time is that as manufacturing jobs started to go elsewhere for a lot of different reasons, all of a sudden the interest of kind of business and the interest of the people who were working in business were not colliding anymore. So business habits that were formed over many, many years, like investing in communities, like sponsoring the symphony, like sponsoring schools, started to dissipate over time. And this is what we got as a result, which was the Occupy Wall Street kind of seismic shift that we saw. So now the question is, what do we do with this? If business is the only place that can create wealth, right? And somehow the interest of business and the people who work in business are not aligned, what's going to happen to us? What are some of the other forces that are driving this? When we talk about manufacturing kind of going elsewhere, what's going on in the world? Well, there are certain places in the world, these are all the leaders of the BRIC countries, there are certain places in the world where business and the workers and the people who are profiting from business are still aligned, right? And these are the folks who are seeing kind of the upswing of the economic development all across the world. So we can see that there actually are some places where new wealth is being created and new markets are being created, and there are incentives for business to address those markets. So that's kind of interesting. There's also been something going on for many, many years, which is about what is the role of business in society and what is the responsible role of business in society. The UN actually wrote a code of ethics that said, here's the role that business should really play. And over time, many organizations have participated in this. There's a really seminal piece of work from the World Resources Institute that's called The Next 4 Billion. And it talks about the fact that there are huge market opportunities for companies in serving the next 4 billion people who are going to live on the planet as they develop their wealth and they become a part of the consuming sector. This is tremendously powerful and exciting for those people, right? Because it means they have access to wealth and resources and a quality of life that they probably wouldn't have had in the past. But this conversation has now shifted for us in the United States, and it feels a little different, and it feels strange, and it feels like we have to find our way again. And I would say that we're getting ready to hit a turning point, and this conference that I went to last week is a large part of that. We're getting ready to hit a turning point because very large organizations with very large infrastructures that sit in the private sector are suddenly realizing that the model is broken, that they can't continue to kind of work the way that they've been working and expect that the markets will continue to grow. Why is this happening right now? There's, and a lot of this is from Michael Porter, there is some indication that the resources that we have in the NGO sector and in the government sector are not big enough actually to meet the needs, right? So we see what's happening in certain Western markets where government doesn't have enough money. We see governments going bankrupt, my own home county of Jefferson County, Alabama. We see things like that happened over the last couple of days when the folks in San Jose decided not to pay the pensions that the police officers have been able to get over time because they're just running out of resources. So we're starting to realize that maybe business actually could play a role in this, in solving this problem. There are increased visibility around societal problems. I have visibility into what's going on in sub-Saharan Africa as a result of things I read on the internet every day that I never would have had 15 to 20 years ago. So it's starting to matter to consumers what's going on in these places, not only in sub-Saharan Africa, but also what's happening in downtown DC. And we have the ability to kind of interact with that and see that on an ongoing basis. And I feel much more compassion and empathy as a consumer, as a participant in this society as a result of that. Social media allows us to connect the dots. So if I feel impassioned about something that's going on in Europe or something that's going on in Asia, I can do something about it. I have now thousands of people in my social network, and we can sign petitions together, and we can exert influence over businesses. So one example that you might know is the Kit Kat palm oil scandal that happened in social media a couple years ago. And I won't go into it directly, but Greenpeace was able to very effectively make kind of a takeoff video showing how the Kit Kat bar was hurting orangutans because of the way that they were farming the palm oil and deforesting there. And Kit Kat and Nestle, in fact, reversed its position on that relatively quickly. We also have the emerging markets and the BRICS and beyond. So these larger business entities are seeing the market opportunity, as I've mentioned before. And the other great thing is we've had incredible traction in the sustainability conversation over the last 7 to 10 years as businesses see that it's in their interest actually to develop practices that actually maximize the way they consume energy more effectively. So they're reducing costs. They're thinking more strategically about the entirety of the supply chain so that they're not kind of doing what they were doing before in terms of polluting and kind of pushing or kicking the can down the road and pushing a lot of the environmental pushes externally. This is we had a session last night at Ogilvy that talked about this exact issue, the fact that the public is now exerting day by day in all of its social media interactions incredible pressure on companies. And the interactions that we have with companies in the way that we buy and the way that we interact on social media and the way we interact with each other is a huge tidal wave of information that companies are having to deal with. So companies are building kind of infrastructure inside to listen, to respond, to be more transparent. You see this both on the consumer marketing side and then also in the way that companies are interacting with investors. There's a huge rise in investor activism as companies think through how they maintain board independence, for example. There's a really interesting conversation going on there as well. So what is all of this driving toward? And it's my position that what we're actually going to see is a transformation among global CEOs of some kinds, not all kinds, that goes from the kind of language that I learned in business school in the mid to late 90s around solely maximizing shareholder value toward a conversation that's kind of still emerging about the health of our overall system. Businesses are starting to understand that they don't exist in isolation, that actually have to build equity for the entire society in order to continue to exist. What are some of the concepts that businesses will be thinking through? It's a conversation around going from around scarcity to a conversation of thinking through what are the opportunities for abundance, what are the opportunities for new markets, for better ways of thinking about energy conservation. It's from known markets, developed world, Western markets to new markets and thinking about that new $4 billion. It's thinking about going from thinking about a closed system to actually thinking about a more global way of addressing our market opportunities. And you can start to see it in companies who are really smart about understanding what the cost to them are of what's used to be called externalities. So there was this concept in business that said, I don't have to worry about polluting that river. I don't have to worry about what happens when the school system in Detroit goes down because housing prices are low and everyone's left. Really smart companies are thinking about the fact that that actually has a real cost to them. And the way that they do business is very much hurt. This is the Paul Pullman, who's the global CEO of Unilever, and he started in 2009, he's really transformed the way that company interacts with the public markets. What he's done is remarkable. The goal is to double their revenue, but actually to cut environmental impact by half. They've pushed hard on nutrition and sustainable sourcing, and they've done something profound. They've eliminated quarterly earnings guidance. So what happens a lot in companies is that the quarterly earnings number actually forces them to take kind of heroic risks to get to that number. This is not required by the SEC, but this is something that has emerged over time as a CEO to investor practice that kind of exerts ridiculous kind of pressure and takes the focus off what they really talk about, which is long-term development. So they think about the world in terms of a 10-year model, a 20-year model, really building companies that will last. And here's how the markets react. So these three lines are, this is from about when Paul started. The green line is actually P&G, their primary competitor. The blue line is actually Unilever, which is the top line. And in business, we often compare to our comparables, so the Dow Jones Industrial Average, to see how well it's done. And you can see there are a million factors that affect this, but Unilever is now consistently outperforming, from a stock perspective, its competitor. There's something really interesting happening here. Now, what does this mean? Where do we go from here? You might have heard that there's this tiny little company in Palo Alto that went public recently. Yeah. It created a massive number of people who are really wealthy, who have all kind of caught the fire of entrepreneurship, and who all have watched Facebook take off, and who all want to go out and invest in their own companies. And what I posit to you is that it's our obligation as people who care about the state of the world and who care about the way we interact between the public, private, and NGO sectors to teach these people who are 24 to 25 to 26 years old about what the role is that we want business to play. And we're only going to do that if we interact on their terms. So what does this mean for you? What should you do? What I would posit to you is you need to help me and others like me build new thinkers, new global business leaders, and you need to help them develop empathy for the work that you do every day. How do you do that? I need you to read the Wall Street Journal. I need you to learn the language of business. I need you to start to think about how you could partner with business more effectively and find those partners. And you'll only do that by kind of reaching into their universe. You need to learn your sector landscape. Which are the companies who are actually playing in the fields that you're interested in? Where are the issues? Where are the emerging markets? Where are the local markets that your business partners might want to work with you on? You need to raise your hand and start to form relationships. So develop relationships with private sector individuals. Start to understand what's driving them, what their performance metrics are, and what they're trying to do within your communities. You need to build a career in solutions. So I think to a certain extent, and I have a deep love and abiding relationship with many people who have built their whole careers in the protest movement. And I love it, and I love the culture of protest. And there will always be something to protest. But if we can all start to move towards thinking about how we get to solutions and build our career equity in solutions, it would be incredibly powerful in developing relationships in business. Finally, you need to invest in companies who step up. You need to find the leaders like the Unilevers, like the Nestle's, like the like several other companies, and start to invest in them, because only as you start to invest in them will you learn their business practices and learn where you can start to exert influence when they step offline. Thank you so much.
All right. So we're going to get started with another quick break. It's going to be about 10 minutes. And we want you to know that coming up, we have one of the founders of Social Marketing who's going to be here today, so that's going to be very interesting. And also, that if you like those kids, we have another special entertainment going on later on this afternoon. So definitely come back and see us, and we look forward to continuing this project and seeing you soon. Thanks, and be back in about 10 minutes, okay? They're going to round you up. All right, see you soon. So the video actually is from Saul Griffith, Kites as the Future of Renewable Energy. Next. We have Andrew coming up next from some Smile. He's executive director. He's all ready to go. Come on, Andrew. Thank you so much for having Andrew.
Hello, everybody. And I have slides, I think, which may appear and may not, and we'll be fine either way. My name is Andrew Barnett, and I'm with SMILE, which is the Sexual Minority Youth Assistance League. We're an organization that supports lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and questioning youth. And I'm here today to talk about how we can really, as a community, work to empower LGBTQ youth as leaders. A lot has changed in the world in the last couple of years for LGBT people, especially here in America. We can look to events like President Obama just a few weeks ago declaring his support for same-sex marriage equality. We can also look at things like the popular television program, I guess my slides aren't coming up, Glee, where there's an openly gay character, Kurt. And it's really tempting to look at all these changes and say, oh my gosh, this is fantastic, we're on the right path, things are great, and things must be so much better for LGBTQ young people. We also know that the average age of coming out has come down significantly over the years. In fact, according to the Centers for American Progress, the average age of coming out for LGBTQ youth now is age 13. And let me step back for a second. When I say LGBTQ, I mean lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and questioning. And I know LGBTQ can be kind of a mouthful, but it's really important to me to be inclusive. So that's the term I'm going to use, and that's what I mean by it. So the average age of coming out now is 13, and coming out is when an LGBTQ young person shares with their family, with their school, with their peers, that they are LGBTQ. And when I actually share this statistic a lot, and when I'm talking to adult members of the LGBT community and I share that the average age of coming out is 13, there's generally an audible gasp in the room because the age has come down significantly. In fact, only 10 years ago, it was closer to 23. And so you think about where a person is when they're 23 versus where they are when they're 13. 23, perhaps they've already completed a four-year college degree or a two-year college degree. Perhaps they're living on their own. Perhaps they have a job. And when you're 13, you don't have any of those things. And generally speaking, you're living with a parent or guardian, and you're really dependent upon those people for support. And you're also an adolescent. And so the support and acceptance of your peers is also incredibly important. And you also have the developmental and emotional skills of a 13-year-old, which are not necessarily as advanced as a 23-year-old. So coming out 13 really presents a very different experience for LGBTQ youth today. And unfortunately, I wish I could stand up here and tell you that it's great and that things have gotten a lot better, and the fact is that's not true. LGBTQ youth are continued to be at higher risk for a number of negative health outcomes, including HIV and STD risk, including substance abuse, alcohol abuse. They're at greater risk for encountering bullying and violence in their schools and in their communities. When you'd only walk down the hallways of any school in America, including those here in DC, and you'll hear young people saying things like, that's so gay, to mean that's so stupid, or you'll hear no homo is also very popular now. And those messages send a very clear message to LGBTQ young people that this is not a safe space for them. This is not a it's not a safe space for them to be who they are. We also know that LGBTQ youth encounter much greater levels of bullying and harassment than just hearing people make stray comments like that. They are often teased in their classes. We also hear about young people who are being physically threatened and assaulted in our schools and in our communities. And so we know that as a community, we have a lot of work left to do. And it's wonderful that we have Kurt from Glee. It's wonderful that we've got national leaders really stepping up and voicing their support for LGBTQ youth. But we know that we're not really going to create the change that we want to see and create communities and families that are truly safe for LGBTQ youth until we really transform our culture. And at the heart of it, one of the fundamental problems that we have to tackle is the fact that we live in a culture that is, on a fundamental level, heterosexist and homophobic. We live in a culture that gives privileges and rights to people who are heterosexual, sometimes at the expense of people who are LGBTQ and who don't fit in those boxes. Think back to the last movie that you saw in the theaters, everyone in the room. And it has to be a fiction movie. It can't be a documentary. And it could have been last week. It could have been 3 years ago. But the last movie that you saw in the theaters. And raise your hands, if you will, if the movie included a heterosexual love story. So two people, you can start raising them. So two people who were either getting together, falling in love, breaking up, hooking up, getting married, who were members of the opposite gender. So like almost everybody has their hand raised. A few people don't. I raised my hand. I think the last movie I saw was The Avengers, and there was a love story in there somewhere amidst the alien invasion. And think back to that same movie and raise your hand if the plot included a same-sex love story. So two members of the same sex hooking up, falling in love, breaking up, getting married, or being in a relationship. So I see one hand, two hands. That's great. That's fantastic. Maybe there was a couple more out there. That's great. That's progress. But also think about how many of the movies that you saw had more than 10 characters in it? Like probably most of them. And statistically, we know that 1 in 10 people are, according to some studies, are LGBT. So representation is one issue. That's just one example of the fact that our culture is still, in very many ways, heterosexist and homophobic. We also know that folks who are LGBT don't always enjoy the same rights. This can include things like the right to marry one's partner. It can also include the right to be free from employment discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation or gender identity. And by the way, in America, 48% of Americans aren't covered by any law that would protect them from that kind of employment discrimination, which I always share because according to other studies, 90% of Americans believe that there is some federal law that bans that, and that's not the case. So we have a long way to go. And for our young people who, again, think back to them, they're coming out at age 13, and they're encountering all of this. They're encountering perhaps rejection from their families, perhaps rejection in their communities, among their peer groups. And so it's very easy to think about them from sort of a pathology perspective. And thinking about the services that they need. And for a lot of these young people, they certainly do need services. They might need access to mental health counseling. They might need access to housing services. Young people still do encounter homelessness on the basis of their sexual orientation or gender identity. But it's also important that when we're thinking about tackling these issues, we also think about LGBTQ youth as advocates and as people that we can be working with to address these. Coming out is a radical act of self-expression and one that has a real impact on not only the young person who comes out, but also the community that they come out in. When a young person comes out in their family and they're the first person in their family to be LGBTQ, that impacts the entire family. When they come out in their schools, that impacts the entire school. And so these young people who are coming out younger and younger are already engaging in a really important form of self-advocacy. We also see that LGBTQ youth are capable of much greater, more organized levels of advocacy. There are things, student clubs all over this country called Gay Straight Alliances, which are very often student-run and student-driven clubs in local schools. Often, in many cases, students have had to really advocate within the school administration and among teachers to even get the right to have these clubs form. And they create safe spaces within a school for LGBTQ students, and they also raise the visibility of LGBTQ students among the entire school community. Gay Straight Alliances and individual students have been involved in a lot of advocacy since these clubs first started becoming formed in the 90s. We've seen the National Day of Silence, which folks may be familiar with. This is a national day of action all over the country now. Students in middle schools and high schools and in college campuses take a vow on this one day in April, a vow of silence. And through their silence, they raise awareness of the silencing of LGBT students. And they force their classes, and they force their teachers, and they force their peers to really think about what does it mean to be LGBT? What is our community like for LGBT people? We also see LGBT student activists being really involved in advocating for policy changes. And that can include wearing the clothes that they're comfortable in to graduation that match their gender identity, match their gender expression. That can include wearing the clothes that match their gender expression to the prom. That can include bringing their same-sex partner or friend to the prom as their date. It can also include advocating for more inclusive policies to address issues like bullying and harassment in schools. And so LGBT youth are stepping up and are showing themselves to be leaders. They're showing themselves to be very capable of advocating for themselves. And again, like you think back, they're coming out 13, they're taking these actions at 13, 14, 15. That's pretty phenomenal. It's pretty amazing. And so for all of us as adults who care about LGBTQ youth, who really want to make our community radically different, want to make our community one that is not homophobic, that's not heterosexist on a fundamental level, want to make our community one where coming out as LGBT is as easy as sharing your favorite color, we really need to be thinking about how we can work with young people, how we can build on the work that we're doing, that they're doing, and work together and make that change that we want to see. And so I hope you all will join me in doing that. Thank you.
All right. So this time I know the next speaker coming up. She's actually standing right there. It's Cheryl Conte. She actually happens to work for Fission Strategy. She actually is a founder of Fission Strategy, as a co-partner. And she's a sister in the social media space, focused on digital strategies with nonprofits and other advocacy organizations. She's also known as Jill Tubman from Jack and Jill Politics, focused on blogging on black politics in America. So it's been pretty interesting. So Cheryl's gonna talk to us a little bit today, and she's up next with her slides. Cheryl.
Thank you, Shireen. Hello, everyone. This is my story. Today, people might know me as an innovative and inspirational technologist who creates award-winning websites and digital campaigns that drive social change. Here's a photo of me. You might wonder, here's a photo of me with Mark Zuckerberg and friends at a Facebook party at South by Southwest. You might wonder what it's like to be the only black woman in a room full of the world's top techies. You might think that I was born a black nerd or blurred, as we're now being called in the media. There it is. The truth is that I was once this kid, just another struggling minority scholarship student hoping to find a job someday that would pay for my fancy Ivy League education. When I first moved into my dorm room at Yale, I told my mother that we'd have to find a way to get me a computer. Otherwise, I just wouldn't be able to compete with the other kids. My mom was a teacher. My father was dead. We didn't really have money lying around. I found a program that allowed me to buy a Mac from the school store and attach it to my student loans. I made all the arrangements, but when the day came to get my new computer, I was scared, terrified. I'd never owned anything that cost so much. So I dragged along my boyfriend from the seventh grade, Michael, on the pretense that it might be heavy, but truly I was just scared of the dang thing. Then I made him sit on my bed while I set it up. I think I was just afraid I'd break it or blow it up or just screw up somehow. Michael was very supportive in the way that only someone who's known you since you were 13 can be. Setting up that Mac SE gave me a big boost of confidence. I felt good that I was able to get it working without too much drama. What really changed my life, however, was this woman, Margaret Krebs. You see, as part of my scholarship package at Yale, I had to have a school job, and I was super broke. The highest paying job on campus was washing dishes in the kitchen. I hate washing dishes, and figured I wouldn't learn much that way. The next highest paying job was a computer assistant helping students in the library and dorm computer labs. So that's what I went for. And that's where I met Margaret. I'm pretty sure I was the first black kid to ever apply for this job. I convinced Margaret that I was a fast learner and that I liked helping other people. So she gave me the job. The first computer assistant meeting was pretty interesting. It was straight out of Big Bang Theory. Out of 30 or so kids, there were only 4 women, and for 3 years, only one black person, me. I don't know why I didn't just turn and run that first day. I think it was because in a room full of misfits, I wasn't alone. And in fact, my fellow computer assistants, who were the geekiest kids on campus you can imagine, were pretty welcoming, although very curious about me. they invested in training me and gave me the confidence that I could learn what I needed to know. And after a few stumbles, I actually came to enjoy it. I never experienced racism from my fellow computer assistants, although sometimes I did from the very people asking for my help with their printer or their floppy disk. After I graduated, I saw the opening in the market. There were a lot of jobs for folks with computer skills. So I steered my career in a direction that would eventually unite my new love of gear and gadgets with my passion for connecting people and creating new ways for their voices to be heard. I've worked with some of the most amazing people on the planet, and this was all because Margaret and my fellow computer assistants looked at me and saw someone who could. From around the time I was struggling to figure out how to use a mouse, through the past few years, there's been a lot of talk about minorities and concern that they are lagging behind in their usage of the internet and computers. This is in part because broadband landlines have been slow to reach minority neighborhoods. Dire predictions arose around the supposed effects of this digital divide, which fortunately have not come true. This iteration of the digital divide is dead. How did it die? First, cell phones became cheaper and therefore more accessible. Then, these same cell phones allowed for internet access. So you had large groups of people who became really good at using the internet on their mobile phones. The phones just kept getting smarter. The mobile internet kept getting faster. Today, whites are the ones who lag behind all other groups in their use of advanced internet, smartphones, and social media. Pew Internet has shown that 28% of black people use Twitter and 13% use it every day. Hispanics are not far behind. Those numbers are 2 to 3 times the rate of white use of Twitter. Women have also taken big strides and now dominate social media. ComScore says that women are the majority of social networking users and spend 30% more time on these sites than men. According to Nielsen, mobile social network usage is 55% female. This shift in influence in favor of women has been tremendous. One example is a new social network called Pinterest, whose user base is about 80% women and whose Facebook page fans are 97% female. Pinterest referral traffic is already approaching levels of Twitter and Facebook. So what? You may be thinking, that's great for black people and Latinos and Asian Americans and Native Americans and chicks. You know, what's in it for me? What do I have to give up in order to create this bright new future for everyone else? I hear you. I work with a lot of white people. I've worked for some white guys, and some white guys have worked for me. I've even dated some white guys. I'm sympathetic to your plight. After all, in 2011, over 50% of the kids born in America were not white. 30 years from now, whites will be the minority. It will be soon in your lifetime for most of the folks hearing this, or at least in your kids' lifetime. As a lifelong card-carrying member of a minority, I've got some advice that can help you make the most of these shifting demographic seas. It's time to get down with the brown. To get jiggy with the jiggly. Jiggly parts, I mean, such as women like me tend to have. Right now, we have a situation where resources are not efficiently finding the best investments because of false assumptions, lack of information, and straight-up bigotry. In a conference full of other venture capitalists, John Doerr said, when you look at all the world's greatest entrepreneurs, quote, they all seem to be white, male nerds who have dropped out of Harvard or Stanford, and they have absolutely no social life. So when I see that pattern coming in, which was true of Google, it was very easy to decide to invest, unquote. Well, I'll be generous and say perhaps Doerr is unaware of the man for whom the term the real McCoy was coined. There was a time when railroads built this great country. A man named Elijah McCoy invented an innovation that helped trains run faster with less need for maintenance and thus more profitably. Railroad executives wanted to know if the locomotives they were running were using the real McCoy, not a cheap knockoff. Elijah McCoy was the son of slaves and happened to be black. Yet even though we still use his invention today in trains, the real McCoy struggled to find capital investment for his groundbreaking invention that changed a nation. 150 years later, not much has changed. Silicon Valley likes to think of itself as a meritocracy, a racism-free zone. And that's the right spirit to have. I've personally benefited from that way of thinking. I've also seen the results of a failure to acknowledge bias and the skewing impact it's having in investment and the distortions it's creating in the marketplace. The old digital divide is dead. We now face a new digital divide, a lack of training and a lack of skilled workers, not a lack of ability or lack of jobs. There's a lack of investment and in content consciously aimed at women and minorities. So let's break that down. Out of the entire city of San Francisco, 15 black kids took calculus last year and only 25 in Oakland. Not impressive. This is just one example of the type of education kids need to prepare for a career in technology that they're just not getting. Right now, today, we have people across the country who need jobs, yet good jobs in technology are going unfilled. Unfilled vacancies at tech recruiting firms in Silicon Valley have tripled in the last year. The shortage is causing instability and salary inflation. Our work is slowed down when we can't find qualified, trained, or even interested people. In addition, the people using the services of tomorrow are not represented in companies creating products for them today. Ultimately, that has to impact the quality of the product. Companies continue to create software, apps, and interfaces with the assumption that their audience is primarily white males. Any marketing pro will tell you you have to know your audience. I recently played a video game that had only two choices of female avatars, a young white woman and a younger white woman. Not exactly a game I buy or recommend. According to a study from Kauffman Foundation, only 4 to 9% of venture capital has gone to women entrepreneurs. So according to my friend Rachel Payne, who leads global alliances at Google, if you're a woman who has been successful in this business, like me, you have bootstrapped, dodged, darted, borrowed, begged, and ultimately innovated past anyone's wildest imagination.
Whoops.
As Dave McClure of 500 Startups has said, that means if a tech company is not headed by a white male college nerd dropout, it's probably undervalued. It's a really good deal. So what's in it for you? Money, opportunity, and power. It's time to recognize that the person who is clicking like in Facebook, or just reblogged a video in Tumblr, or uploaded a photo to Instagram, or retweeted it on their cell phone is more likely to be black or brown. Those are the companies that will succeed and make the most money in the future. While I may stand out in a crowd of geeks now, this will change with or without your help. Nor will it make this country stronger and more prosperous if we are solely reliant on importing talent from countries that frankly have better educational systems than ours. Josh Mailman and Drew Bernard didn't invest angel funding in my new software product called Attentively because they feel sorry for me. My clients like One Campaign or Moms Rising or Earth Justice didn't hire me because they feel sorry for me. My staff didn't come to choose to work with me because they feel sorry for me. They saw the results I've been able to create helping amazing organizations touch millions of lives. They looked past my race and gender and saw someone with whom they could do good while doing good. How do you get in on this action? If you own a big tech company, consider setting up free or low-cost training in computer programming, robotics, or basic engineering at a school in a poor or mostly minority neighborhood. Think of these as fertile recruiting grounds where you can cherry-pick among overlooked talent willing to work harder and more cheaply than you might imagine. If you're a teacher, consider infusing more tech talk, no matter the subject you teach. Inspire your students to see themselves succeeding in the world of technology. If you're a parent, let your kids play video games. Sheryl Sandberg, the COO of Facebook, recently said that all the female technologists she knows played video games as kids. When I heard that, I could only think back to the many hours I spent playing Pac-Man and Frogger with my brother on our Atari 800. He's a pilot today. Both of us landed in careers that require comfort with tech. He has to run training simulations all the time. He says it's a lot like a video game. If you're a leader or a lawmaker, advocate for more job training. Let's invest more in our education system. Inner city schools can be places where you find not only the best football players and rappers, but also where the next best technological geniuses come from. If you're a venture capitalist, consider adding some companies to your portfolio that show diversity. That's not affirmative action, and it's not a handout. Diversifying your investments is just smart investing. Anyone will tell you that. Open your mind. Anyone can be a geek. We come in all shapes, all colors, and all sizes, even blurreds like me. Open your wallet. It takes money to make money. And now is the time to invest with imagination. Information is the new oil. It's the new railroad. Open your heart. Margaret Krebs touched millions of lives through changing one person's life, mine. True power comes from nurturing new power. We have the power to shape the future and to decimate the new digital divide. You have the power to determine your role in a new era. Not only can we bury racism and sexism, but set the stage for a stronger, more prosperous future for ourselves and for our country. Now that's what's up. Thank you very much.
As you can imagine, I feel that. I definitely feel that. So I so appreciate Cheryl's talk today, because I actually was a kid in the projects in New York City. So you can imagine playing video games for a kid that lived in the projects was an amazing feat. And so I really appreciate that, because that's the truth, that I'm in technology today because I fell in love back then. And I was doing Frogger and Pac-Man and all that. And actually, the truth was, I was really good at it. I used to go to the video arcade store all the time, and the worker there, the guy who owned the place, used to kick me out because I would play on one quarter and he couldn't make any money. So at the end of the day, anybody who came to compete with me was going to lose, and so nobody wanted to play the game if I was standing there. So the guy used to kick me out all the time. Luckily, my mother supported me, which is I'm really fortunate to have. She actually got the Atari, and I had it at home, so I got to play Pac-Man and Frogger and all those things all by myself. And of course, that continued for me as well. So it is key. It is very important that it happens early. It's very important that we do that that injection of where technology is. And this is not to just say that now that we're in social media, that having these mobile phones is just the easy access for them to play those games. We really have to dig a little bit deeper now, because it's just so prevalent and people assume a lot with it. So there's more to do there, another force of change. It's a little bit different, but definitely video games is the start of it all. So up next, so our next speaker, Bill Novelli. He actually happens to be someone who started a company a long time ago. Porter Novelli. Happened to do something like that. He actually ran a couple other companies as well as CEO. But he also was a founder of some of the social marketing that we see today. So he's going to talk to you a little bit about something slightly different, because I guess you could talk about it as a start, as the father of something. He's going to talk a little bit about dying and transitioning to that. So, Bill.
Thank you, Shireen. Hello, everybody. So I'm Bill Novelli. I'm at the business school at Georgetown University. And the subject I want to talk to you about this afternoon is dying better in America. And that's what I said, dying better in America. Now, there's an old story among gerontologists. And what it basically says is that everybody should live to a ripe, wonderful old age. And then they should die by a quick bullet, fired by a jealous lover. But most Americans don't go into the great beyond that way. So let me give you a couple of examples. This is a book called Having Your Own Say, Getting the Right Care When It Matters Most. It's just out. And I want to quote from the foreword to this book by a guy named Tom Consumpis. And he says, quote, "Another trip to the emergency room in the middle of a frigid night was not what Mom wanted, nor was it what my sister and I wanted for her. Our mother was a proud woman who had lived independently for years with multiple chronic conditions. However, she was 85 years old, frail, and on this night, she had the symptoms of a mild stroke. So what else could we do? This was a recurring cycle over many years. Late at night, simple answers to simple questions did not come quickly, but were discovered only after putting Mom through tiresome rounds of ER protocol, CT and MRI scans, and countless forms to fill out. Communication among the numerous specialists treating Mom was seriously lacking. Another example comes from last week's New York Magazine. I recommend this article to you, but it's a little tough to read. It's by a man named Michael Wolff, and he calls it A Life Worth Ending. He says, the cost for my mother, who is 86, and for the past 18 months has not been able to walk, talk, or to address her most minimal needs, and who is absent short-term memory, come in at about $17,000 a month. And while her long-term care insurance hardly covers all that, I'm certainly grateful she had the foresight to carry such a policy. But long-term care insurance helps finance some of the greatest misery and suffering human beings have yet devised. Everybody would manage his or her parents' decline differently. We all mess it up. We agreed with a cardiologist to perform surgery on my mother when she was 84. My siblings and I must take the blame here. It did not occur to us once to say, you want to do major heart surgery on an 84-year-old woman showing progressive signs of dementia. Are you nuts? The operation absolutely repaired my mother's heart. She can live for years, according to the surgeon, who we never saw again. But before, where we were sinking gently, now we were in free fall. She was reduced to a terrified creature, losing language skills by the minute. She certainly appears agitated, the psychiatrist sent to administer antipsychotic drugs told me, and so do you. 6 weeks and something like $250,000 in hospital bills later, paid by Medicare, she was returned, a shadow being, to her assisted living apartment. Now, what do people want when they have advanced illness, when they're seriously ill? Here's what they want. Number one, they want to be at home with their family and their friends. They want to have their pain managed. They want their spiritual needs to be addressed. And they want the people who love them not to be financially and emotionally devastated by the process. Now, what do people get? They get aggressive care, often overly aggressive care, that neither they nor their families wanted, which doesn't prolong quality of life at all. And secondly, they get huge costs to the family, to society, and to the Medicare system. Now, this is going to get worse before it gets better. Why? Because America is aging. In 20 years, more than one out of every five Americans is going to be 65 or older. Secondly, more and more people are living with chronic conditions. And third, technology is really improving. So now we're reaching a stage where we can keep people alive almost no matter what their condition. Now let me tell you what this is not about. This is not about pulling the plug on grandma. This is not about rationing care. And this is not about death panels. Now, I talked to a physician from UCLA. He has a 90-year-old woman on a ventilator. And every week, he calls her daughter. And what he says to the daughter is, your mother's not getting better. Are you sure this is what you want for your mother? And every week, the woman says the same thing, which is, you have to understand, we are a family that believes in miracles. Now, if that's the kind of family you are, then you should have the kind of care that you want for your mother. Take a 34-year-old woman, a young woman with breast cancer and little kids. She's going to fight to the end. She's going to want every kind of heroic care that she can get, and she should have it. But when you offer most people, and most of these people are frail elderly and their adult children, when you offer them the options that they want, most of the time they elect less care, not more care. Now, what's it going to take to change all this? It's going to take four things. Number one, we have to engage the public. We have to have the public understand that they need to plan in advance. So when you're 50 or 60, when you're 65 and you go into Medicare, think about advance directives. The time to think about this is not when your spouse is on the floor and you're dialing 911. And think about the options that you have when you talk to your medical care team, the options that your parents have if you're taking care of them. So engaging the public is really important. The second thing is we have to help healthcare providers. No healthcare provider wants to do the wrong thing. They all want to do the right thing, but they need help. They need help with communication and pain management and all the other things that I've been talking about. And the third thing we need to do is to do what works. There are good clinical models in this country. And what we need to do is to document them and promulgate them and seed them around the country. And what they do basically is provide the right care at the right time in the right place, oftentimes at home. And the last thing we need to do is we need to create policy change. We need to change the reimbursement system. We need new regulations for standards and other things that have to take place on Capitol Hill and in Sacramento and in Albany and in Tallahassee. Those are the things we need to do. Now, why do I think this is possible? And I admit to you I'm an optimist. I think it's possible, first of all, because of the boomers. The baby boomers are the largest population cohort in American history. And anybody who knows anything about the boomers knows that they've always been catered to and that they are very aggressive and very feisty. And the boomers are not going to tolerate the nonsense that's going on today. The second thing is cost. As I said to you earlier, this whole system is essentially unsustainable, not just to Medicare, not just to the taxpayers, but to families, to individuals. This is the biggest cause of bankruptcy in America. The third reason why I think things are going to change is because we can take advantage of personal stories. Everybody has a story. Everybody has a story about a loved one. I was talking to Senator Rockefeller. Here's a man who's worth hundreds of millions of dollars. His mother died over 7 years of dementia, and Senator Rockefeller is unhappy because it was a bad death, and he wants to do something about it. I have a story about my father. I'll bet you all have stories about loved ones as well. And the last reason why this is going to change is CTAC, the Coalition to Transform Advanced Care. Now, I read to you from an excerpt from this foreword of the book by Tom Kintsoupis. He co-chairs CTAC, and I'm the other co-chair. CTAC is a growing coalition with all kinds of members, healthcare providers, big insurance companies, consumer groups like the Cancer Society and the Heart Association and AARP, the hospice and the palliative care people, faith-based groups, and we've got Liftoff. And I think CTAC is going to make a big difference. So none of us are going to get out of this alive. We might as well fix this. We might as well fix this for our grandparents and for our parents and for ourselves. And working together, we can do it, from Adams Morgan to Capitol Hill to the whole country. Thanks very much. I'm not sure how long that took. I didn't.
Now, entertainment. We're going to get ready for Studio G. We're going to make a transition. Thank Bill again for his conversation, talking about getting to the places of dying just a little bit better in our society. Although there's a lot of challenges with that, I guess. I almost died when I was like 10 years old. They had to kill me for a second and bring me back. So thankfully, technology works and doctors are doing some fantastic things. And I'm standing here as a result of that. So I know I spend my life focused on living instead of dying. But, you know, there's sometimes you have to think about what's going to happen towards the end. So up next is going to be another entertainment, a dance troupe, Studio G, that we're looking forward to. We're going to set the stage for them. And basically, we're looking to, this is the last event for the evening, so we're getting ready to wrap up. However, I want to thank all the speakers, definitely, for being here. And definitely want to thank all the entertainers for being here as well. And so let's give them a hand. It's definitely been a diverse day, and with some fantastic visits to Ecuador and to, you know, all kinds of different places like China, like India. So happy to start this off with ending it with Studio G.
My son, you do not remember me. I am Jor-El. I am your father.
All right, well, ladies and gentlemen, what you just witnessed is a dance style called popping. And I'm trying to think of what is the relevance to a TED Talks, right? Obviously, we represent the entertainment portion, but I can't help but notice how technology influences the way we move. You know, you may have noticed that up until about 50, 60 years ago, there was no such dance style called the robot, right? But obviously, the way we move, I mean, electronics inspires the way we move. Another interesting thing that you may have noticed about it is the type of movement is not natural. You know, people don't naturally, you know, do that. You know what I'm saying? And that's part of its allure and what makes it so cool. And so I'm going to ask for a little audience participation right now. And you can remain seated, so you can all relax, all right? Just lift your arm up just like this, okay? And I challenge you to just go like that. A simple arm wave is what that is. Perhaps you've been driving down the highway on a nice day like today. You roll down the window and you catch the breeze, right? So this is not overly impressive. However, don't get too proud of yourself. But if you try to go like that and isolate from your elbow to your shoulder, all of a sudden it becomes much more challenging because it's simply not a natural way of moving. And that's why it makes people say, whoa, what just happened? And you take it one step further into that shoulder isolation, and then you got a real nice, smooth-looking arm wave. So you guys can practice that. I expect to see you all out tonight at some kind of nightclub working on it, okay? And, yeah, the after party, there you go. And, hey, but to wrap it up and tie it all together, I'm going to turn it over to Guo.
Well, I was here for most of the conference, so I had the benefit of hearing a lot of the early speakers, and there was a common theme that was a part of several of the first half of the day, and it was about the young people out there and about their passion and how fired up they get. And I wanted to say, with regard to my experience here, I'm quite a bit older than these other dancers. Most of them are young enough to be my kids, and I started popping when I was 35, 36, so I'm somewhere in my 40s now. But when I'm dancing with these kids, I see that they have as much passion for this and they spend as much time on it as any of us would some project at work or anything like that. And a lot of times, as we get older, we forget. We sometimes think that these kids have no direction. It's mainly that we may not be interested in the same things. And when I'm dancing with them, I don't feel there to be an age difference between us. I just see us as everyone pursuing the same passion, everyone pursuing with the same focus. And it's really easy, if you just let yourself, to forget about the age differences and just enjoy the person's creativity and energy for what it is. Because that's really, when it comes down to it, it doesn't matter how old they are. But because urban dance is skews so young in general, I just thought it would be worth noting that I've noticed that as we've gotten older, a lot of us just don't pay attention to them anymore. It's not so much that they don't exist or they don't have direction. So, but that's basically it. I hope you enjoyed the performance. Thanks for having us out and giving us the opportunity to share what we do.
All right. Cool.
Well, I hope you're all inspired by the performances. We had singing, we had dancing, and we had some tremendous big ideas that were presented. We promised you, if you have your program in front of you, we promised you that today we would really talk about the forces of change and how they're gathering strength around the globe. As we shared in the program, today, like so many who have gone before us, we now too are faced with an imminent choice. We can cower in fear and turn away from the forces of change that bear upon us, or we can rise up and face them together. And I think today we had a wonderful group of speakers, performers, artists who helped to embody that very vision. And really, it's been an honor to be able to share this conversation with you today. As you heard earlier, there were some mentions of an after party. We do have an after party where we're going to be able to continue the amazing conversation. As you all know, TEDx is about big ideas, and we're hoping that this is the beginning of a conversation of all of those wonderful big ideas that we started to have here today. I want to acknowledge our wonderful MC, Shireen Mitchell, who did a tremendous job today. Thank you. And our speakers, Amardeep Singh, Jose Antonio Tijerino, Brian English, Ivan Baki, Kavita Patel, Crystal, Lauren High, who was not here today, but who I know was here with us in spirit. The performances that we had from Earth's Natural Force Rangers, which I know really inspired and thrilled all of us. Emily June, Marie Mann, Lori Kaplan, Rebecca Davis, Andrew Barnett, Cheryl Conti, Bill Novelli, and of course, the wonderful performance we just had from Studio G. I'd also like to take a moment to acknowledge the tremendous team that put this together with me. If you could all please stand. Really an honor to put it together with all of you. And I just realized I didn't introduce myself, so by way of introduction, my name is Katie Esquivel, and I am honored and humbled to have been able to partner with these amazing folks who many of us were strangers 4 months ago and met for the first time to put together an event that we hoped would help to germinate this conversation, which would continue in this wonderful neighborhood of Adam Morgan that has such a tremendous and rich history related to the forces of change. And so thank you all again for everything. Truly appreciate it. I also want to make sure to acknowledge our wonderful hosts here of the Sitar Center. Maureen Dwyer, who's the executive director of the Sitar Art Center, will be coming on stage and sharing some closing words from the Sitar Art Center. And then we'll hand it over to Shireen so she can tell you about the after party and how you can join us.
Good evening, or afternoon. Are we at evening? I'm Maureen Dwyer. I'm the Executive Director of Sitar Arts Center, and I just want to express my gratitude for such a wonderful day. My heart and mind are very full, swimming with ideas, and that's really what Sitar Arts Center is about. So we're just very grateful to be included in today and honored to host this wonderful event. The timing was really perfect, because when we were approached by TEDx about having the event here today, we were grateful that it was in the little narrow window of Sitar Arts Center when not that much is going on. So 2 weeks ago, we wrapped up our spring semester, during which 550 students came to the center every week to develop and discover their gifts in music, dance, creative writing, visual arts, digital arts, and theater. And our mission here at Sitar Arts Center is to reach out to families and children who just wouldn't otherwise have these opportunities. 80% of our students come from low-income households, and that defines to about $30,000 or less for a family of four surviving in this neighborhood. One of the things I admire and cherish about Adams Morgan is its diversity and the fact that amidst all of the growth and the rapid rise of just beautiful and wonderful businesses and arts organizations and industry, we've also hung on to and retained the essential low-income housing. Sitar Arts Center, although we've only served our community for 12 years, really has its roots and is an outgrowth of Jubilee Housing, which has been in the neighborhood for many, many decades, making sure that people who can't afford the traditional cost of living in Washington, D.C., have an opportunity to live in our wonderful city. Yeah, thank you. Sitar Arts Center is able to achieve its mission because of community. First and foremost, we build community around our young people to nurture them and to help them know that they are loved, supported, and that we believe in their gifts. At Sitar Arts Center, we believe the force of change is children. We believe that every child is gifted, and it's merely a matter of looking inside oneself to discover what those gifts are, and then having the people and the support needed to really develop them. And unfortunately,
It's the kids who don't get those opportunities that don't always realize their potential. So for us, the force of change is making sure that every student who comes our path is able to realize their potential. And we can only do that because of a unique mission of community. Every week at Sitar, 100 volunteer artists come to share their gifts with the kids of our community because they believe in the power of arts to transform lives, and they believe in our young people. Additionally, we have partnering arts organizations from all over the city who bring curriculum and programs and performances to strengthen our community. This includes the Corcoran, the Washington Ballet, City Dance Ensembles, many of the finest arts organizations in the city. And then we have our fabulous donors who support us and uphold our children. So it's a full community of supportive adults built around our kids to believe it and make sure that they can be a force of change. So, I'd like you to know that if it's your first time here today, you are now part of our community, so welcome. Please leave your business card out in the little fishbowl on your way out, and we'll be sure to keep you posted about everything going on here at Sitar. Something to look forward to, in just a week we start our summer program. We're going to have 150 kids coming every day for multidisciplinary arts education and to start rehearsing our annual summer musical. Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat is this summer's performance. It's the hottest ticket in town. They're free, but they go fast. So call early in July if you'd like to come and enjoy the wonderful performance that our kids are sure to give you. Plus, this summer, we are employing 38 teens. In fact, they'll be coming in for their orientation as you're leaving today. So be sure to give them a high five. They are choosing to spend their summer developing their gifts, helping younger children, creating community murals out in public, and doing all the technical support for our show. So thank you for being here with us today. I know you've been listening all day, so I'm going to stop talking. But if you want to know anything more about Sitar, my door is always open. I'd love to hear from you. Thank you for being part of the incredible Adams Morgan community. It is our joy and honor. We love the Adams Morgan community, and we are so grateful to be a part of it. Thank you.
All right. I'm the last person that you will see tonight. We're going to go to happy hour, except for I'm going to talk about a couple of things. I just wanted to, just say again, this was such an amazing day, such a great diversity of speakers, some interesting topics that I hadn't even thought about, and I'm just so happy to be a part of that because diversity is very important to me, and also I love my city, and I love the things that are going on here, and we need to share more of that, and I love the fact that we're able to do that with TEDx with video and everything else. A couple things. One is there's a survey they want you to fill out if you can before you leave. When you go out the door, on the front desk there are a couple of laptops. You can also go into the Google room if you want to fill out the survey, as well as check out Google Places. So that's still an opportunity to do before you leave today. Afterwards, or after you fill out the survey, please walk to Casa Oaxaca. I was like, I was trying to get it. Oaxaca. All right. So at least y'all know. Y'all must be from this area. Y'all must know that place. I've never been there before, actually. That's one of the places I'm going to have to go. So it's 2106 18th Street Northwest. Now, since I heard so many people say the name properly, that means you know where it is, right? yeah, that's a good question. Is it Wyoming? I actually have, like, these directions. So I can say them, and if you don't remember, it's fine, but 2106 18th Street. It's left out the door, then a left on Chaplin, then a right on Calorama again, and left on 18th Street. And it's across the street from an orange building. How about we just aim for the orange building and look for Oaxaca after that?
It itself is orange.
It's south, you said?
It itself is an orange building.
Okay.
And we'll be walking together. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So that no one gets lost, you want to make sure you get there. Also, if you're like me, you got your phone, I'm just going to use my GPS and follow it as I get to the place that I'm going to. That's what technology is for. But I definitely want to say, again, thanks to the team and everyone here.
It has been my honor. My name is Shereen Mitchell. Again, I'm the original digital sister. You can find me on Twitter, anywhere, social media. It's been my honor to be your MC today, and I thank everyone for spending the time with us. See you at the next one.